welcome to 4Player Podcast, episode 481. My name is Nick Henderson. I'm joined today by Brad Simons.
Hello.
Who is currently eating a...
No.
Sugar cookie.
Sorry, just finished eating a sugar cookie flavored Pop-Tart. I didn't know that was real.
I appreciate...
Is that like a holiday thing?
I appreciate its subtlety.
Fair enough.
Thank you.
Fair enough. Nolan Hedstrom is joining us as well.
Hey, everybody.
And of course, Christopher Guthridge.
Hello.
How's everybody doing?
Bad.
I feel like we haven't done this in
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
Yeah.
I guess we did last week. We did a
board game.
We did a board game.
It's actually been about 13 days.
It was a fantastic board game night.
Yeah, Brad, you missed a fantastic board game night. We played that one game.
It was so good.
Machikoro.
Thank you. Yeah. Machikoro, and we played Sushi Goat.
I couldn't keep up. I couldn't follow along.
Really?
Wait, were you watching?
No.
Wine and board game.
What?
Well, there you go. That probably...
Was it fun for viewers? I don't know. I'm always worried about board game nights. About, well, can they really see everything? Do they need to, you know?
They don't really
We should
to.
Just play D&D.
That, I mean, it took all of, like, 5 seconds once Crispy walked in the door for him to, like, make that suggestion.
I'm going to break out all my dice and books.
He's like, I've got it all in the car. I'm ready to go.
I just carry it with me. It's my bug out bag. When the apocalypse comes, I'm gonna have all my D&D stuff.
Oh my lord! So yeah, we had a good board game night / Thanksgiving. I hope everybody out there in the world had a great. Okay, maybe not in the world.
I had a pretty good time at the Grand Canyon.
Oh yeah, you did. You did. You filmed a Brad Appetit.
Yeah.
Out
How
at
come
the Grand
you didn't
Canyon?
Ask me about the Grand Canyon?
I just read my National Geographic.
I was there like a fucking month ago.
Oh, I mean, I didn't remember.
I didn't see any pictures of you at the Grand Canyon
Wait,
a month ago.
Wait, this is bullshit. There was something else that happened like fairly recently that I did that was cool, but you did it like the week before and it was less cool. Remember that? Well, what the fuck was that?
Got Bowling. Married?
No. not that.
That too.
It was like I went to a place that was kind of cool, but you had just went to it.
Mm.
God, what the fuck was that?
I don't remember.
Why are you keep... Fuck you.
Dude, I went to Arizona. Do you not remember when I went to Arizona? Thanks for being a bro. Do you not remember when I couldn't be on the podcast because I was in Arizona?
That's why you couldn't be on the podcast?
Yes. And then I was like right by the Grand Canyon, so I went to the Grand Canyon.
In Arizona.
Yes.
So
that's where the Grand Canyon is. Maybe. It's a big fucking hole.
The Grand Canyon.
Oh, the medieval,
Renaissance Festival?
The Renaissance Festival.
Oh, that's right.
Remember that?
Yeah.
Fucker.
Yeah, it was way less cool when you did it.
Yeah.
I was climbing out on rocks and shit, and Malia was horrified.
Dude, yeah, that like Bernadette's mom.
That's how people die.
It was me, Bernadette, and her parents, and I kept walking up. Because there's, you know, the Grand Canyon, it's got railing on maybe like a 1/100,000th of it.
Yeah, yeah.
And the rest of it's just open. And so like I would just walk up to the edge and look over and her mom's like, no, stop. She's like taking a picture. She's like, I'm sending this to your mother.
Well,
I mean, that is a legit concern. That's a little bit crazy.
I mean, Bernadette dropped our DSLR lens cap into the Grand Canyon.
Okay, I thought you were about to stop at DSLR.
It was funny. She was pulling it out of the bag and the lens cap dropped, and it was that literal slow motion where it's like ting, ting, and then starts rolling, and I'm like, no, and it just rolls off the edge.
Well, I went out onto one of the, like...
Alcove things.
Yeah, I mean,
it goes out.
Yeah. It seems real scary, but once you kind of start making your way out there, and you're like, this seems safe. You know? Like, I saw another person do that earlier, so I'm going to do it now. But it was bad enough to where Malia was not even going close. And I was trying to get her to, like, come out with me so we could film the Ape Tit out there. And she's like, no, you're going to be pulling shit out of the bag and you're just going to fall. and she would not let me go back out there with the phone to record myself either. That's how kind of precarious it was. But it was a good time.
You know what you should have done? Can't you, like, ride donkeys down the Grand Canyon?
In some places, probably not where he was.
Should have done that and filmed anything, it while you're on the donkey.
Anything at the Grand Canyon that's not just, like, looking off
is really
the edge
expensive.
Of the Grand Canyon is just, like, hundreds of dollars a person, so.
It's also really spread out. It's not, like, they have, like, different places around, like, the national park where you can go to, like, do the shit. Like, where were you at when you did it? Were you on the
South Rim?
The South? Were you on that, like... That one road that kind of runs off the side or right by the visitor center?
No, we weren't by the visitor center. We were off on, one of the side roads.
Okay, yeah. That's what I figured, though, because there wasn't that many people.
No,
like, the thing is, if you ever go to the Grand Canyon, don't go to the visitor center.
Oh, God.
Like, when you're there, that's where everyone fucking is. There's a road, I forget the name of it. It's like something point or something yeah. like something Head, point
heads out towards
yeah it just follows the rim of the Grand Canyon, and it's like literally like a 10-mile road, and like every like mile there's just like a point where you can walk mm-hmm. out and mm-hmm. go look at it, and like there's maybe two people at each of them. Nice. it's much nicer just because at the right by the visitor center there's like hundreds and hundreds of people.
I will try my best to remember that.
Just not even watching them.
Yeah,
I will try my best to remember that when I eventually finally maybe go to the Grand Canyon.
Long story short, it's a big hole.
Big hole in the ground.
The thing is, it doesn't look real. I saw it from a
plane recently.
Yeah, it doesn't look
real. It doesn't look real when you're looking at it.
That's like a skybox or a green screen.
And I think it's just because you've never seen something that big.
It's too big. It's hard to process.
Yeah, your brain doesn't comprehend it. And so like looking at it, it's like you're like doing like a fucking double take.
Grand?
Yeah. Pretty grand.
Yeah. Yeah.
Speaking of grand, we're going to talk about video games today. We actually got a lot.
Well, there's still more non-video game related stuff.
Is there?
Yes. I finished watching fuck.
Don't tell us about that.
Was it the dope FX show Atlanta?
No. Well, you came over to my house and I was watching it, Brad.
Final Fantasy? This is riveting.
God damn it. Okay, so anyway,
I saw Arrival.
Oh yeah, how was that?
Excellent.
Nice.
Excellent movie. One of my favorite sci-fi movies I've seen in a long time.
Twin Peaks. Twin Peaks. I finished watching Twin Peaks.
So who killed Laura Palmer?
Well, you find that out in like the beginning of season two.
Yeah. It doesn't even matter.
It doesn't. That show gets fucking weird at the end.
That show gets fucking weird from the start.
Oh, yes. But it gets even like weirder. And then the thing is, I didn't realize that the show got canceled. And so it ends on like a cliffhanger. Now I know Fire Walk With Me is the movie, then that explains some of it. And I haven't gotten to that yet, and I'm going to. But yeah, just the way it ends is fucking weird.
Well, don't tell us.
I'm not going to. But anyway,
wrapped in plastic.
When is the new season?
Next year.
Oh,
I think sometime early next year. Yeah. Netflix or
I don't remember.
Amazon? I thought it was Netflix.
Yeah, it is. Or it Netflix. Might be. Amazon. Yeah, I think it's Netflix.
It's one of the streaming services. Yeah.
But anyway, the other thing I did.
Brad, did you turn the AC down to like 50 degrees? My hands like.
I think you're all right.
I don't think his AC's that good. I wanted to talk about this four part crossover.
And no, I haven't. Okay, I haven't seen anything.
Okay, so hold on, real quick. It's fucking bullshit. It is not a four part crossover.
Okay, Well, first of all, he's talking about the stupid. First of all, you don't want to hear about this. This is CW related.
It's four Arrow, different Flash, self-contained Supergirl. Episodes that don't have anything to do with each other.
No, it's Flash. Supergirl, Flash, Arrow, and then Legends of Tomorrow. The thing is, it starts with Supergirl. At an entire episode of Supergirl, and the last like 30 seconds are something's going on. Continue on Flash, and then Flash, it starts with exactly what was in Supergirl. It was three parts. It's a fucking three-part crossover with a fucking trailer for the three-part at the end of the Supergirl. I was kind of mad. Like okay, that. First of all, I was getting all hyped up for this four-part crossover. I thought we had gone
a very long time without bringing up...
This is an MCU household.
Oh my fucking God, we had to listen about your wedding.
What?
We could talk about our shows, man.
Are y'all still
wait, you talking about Flash for the 100th episode is the equivalent to me talking about my wedding one episode?
There haven't been 100 episodes of Flash. I don't think we've talked
about it. No, but we've talked about it.
For I think man, that 100th we've talked episode, about though. The Flash on 100 episodes of our podcast.
More episodes than actually exist of the Flash.
Some CW show in some form.
Okay.
I haven't watched any of it. In fact, I'm like...
This is an MCU household.
I'm like a season or two at... behind on every one of those
shows. Well, I mean, I stopped watching Arrow, and I have no intention of rewatching it. Legends of Tomorrow, I couldn't get into it for some reason. I'm sure it's probably gotten better than when it started.
I mean, it depends on what you mean by that.
So probably not. I am caught up
because
on Flash.
Because it was always amazing, and it just stayed amazing.
I'm caught up on Flash and Supergirl. and holy shit, this season of Flash is fucking good.
Yeah.
It's I have still only seen the first season of
the Flashpoint.
Yeah.
Isn't season two on Netflix now?
I think so.
Yeah.
You know what I started watching? I think. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Oh really? My God.
I don't know why, but I can't bring myself to watch
Hold
that.
Hold on. How far are you?
No, I was kidding.
Fuck you. Fuck you.
It's just this guy can't watch an X-Men movie, but he's seen every episode of DC's
Go on.
You're going to go to bat Avengers? For the X-Men movies. You're going to go to bat for the X-Men movies. That's the hill you want to die on. The X-Men movies. What is the fucking X-Men movie?
What is it? Legends
Hugh Jackman,
of Tomorrow?
You just want to get on your knees and slob his dick all day, don't you? Legends. His adamantium
let's not,
dick.
Let's not bring Hugh Jackman into this, does okay? He didn't do anything wrong.
All his bones.
Well, but the dong bone. Yeah.
Oh, that works.
Can we talk about video games now? Or is there anything else?
No, I'm good, yeah. Video games.
Because we've got a lot of video games to talk about today.
What kind of feedback?
Oh, I do have feedback from our last podcast episode. Thank you, Brad.
I don't know if you meant mic feedback or... We should do feedback.
We should do feedback. We have feedback. So we had a podcast, like I said, 2 weeks ago. We talked about Dishonored 2. We talked about Tyranny, Robinson. Oh, my God. Our last episode was where I talked about Robinson.
It's Robinson the Journey.
Robinson the Journey. Our
Fabled
first,
the Journey?
Yeah. Oh, God. Bring that up. Okay. our first bit of feedback this week comes from One Button to Rule, who's also known as you may know him as the Metal Button. He says, with respect to Persona... Because mm-hmm. Nolan is playing Persona. Mm-hmm. The common consensus I hear from you dicks when discussing the game is that playing through a Persona game can be a chore, mm-hmm. even though you all generally praise the game. I picked up Persona 4 Golden on Vita as my first entry in the series and only got about 4 hours in. I find the ratio between talking and playing so far on the talking side that I can't be bothered.
So I will say, any Persona game you play... Very front-loaded with story.
Yes.
All Persona games start with a shit ton of story, too much for their own good.
It takes a while before you even get to like the first like
dungeon. Like I was saying, I wasn't being too facetious last podcast when I mentioned I was 7 hours in, so I was close to the end of the tutorial. Yeah. That's not too far from the truth.
They spend a lot of time on the social aspect and setting up the story and mm-hmm. all the characters before they even really explain how the combat system works in a lot of ways.
Yeah, so I mean, if you're going to play a Persona game... just realize what he said, 4 hours?
Yeah, he said he did end his comment by saying maybe I just need to invest more time until I get to the meat and potatoes.
These are, you know, easily...
No, that is the meat and potatoes, man.
Well, hold on. So these are easily 100-hour games. So I wouldn't stop at 4 hours and just be done with it. I would say at least play 10 to 15. And if by that time you're not into it, you probably won't ever be. But I'm just saying, don't only give it 4 hours. Just like I said, like it can get a while to get started. But yeah, that is the core concept of the game, is, you know, going to school and relationship with your school friends, and you know, doing like odd jobs and whatever, mixed with exploring the, you know, the alternate world where you're doing combat and stuff like that.
Most of the game is watching transition screens, anyways.
I mean, not necessary. I mean, I guess yeah.
Well, I mean, like. The flow of the game is actually just kind of going from the day to day. Man, I feel bad for not voicing my opinion as to which banner I preferred on our thing.
You preferred the other one?
Yeah, you liked the faces?
Yeah.
Oh, man, me too.
Why? I don't even
Everyone
know what the fuck
feel
that
crazy.
Is.
Those are the fucking things from Kingsglaive.
That's
the old Kings
that's
of...
That's clearly like a Yojimbo.
By the way, Kings of Lucis. I don't want to get too far off topic here, but mm-hmm. I did watch Kingsglaive last night. We can talk about this some other time. Mm-hmm. But that monster that was like flattening the city at the end of Kingsglaive, that mm-hmm. was totally like
Diamond Weapon from Final Fantasy VII.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like straight up.
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry. Our next feedback is also Persona related.
Nice.
From Gonzo Lude.
Of course.
Here's two reasons why you're wrong, Nolan, in thinking the Persona 4 Golden Chie's voice is worse than the other. One, the golden one actually sounds like a high school student and not a 40-year-old woman from the last voice actress.
Ouch.
Two, Erin Fitzgerald, who is the voice actress in the golden version, is based. What?
Just read it all, and we'll figure it out.
Erin Fitzgerald is based, and that is a fact. I don't know what
you don't understand anime person.
It's youth
speech.
Culture.
Yeah.
Oh God, am I out of touch?
Nick's you're old. Based. You're
old.
Based.
Yeah, you're old.
Oh no, I'm showing my age.
Wait, Nick is
old.
No. Is based good or bad?
Nick is not based. Based is good.
Yeah. What
based
is that? Is
you're good. Unbased.
You're not based at all.
You're so unbased.
I welcome, you know, that a counterpoint. I mean, I personally. I'm being where I'm at now in the game, I don't know, 40 something hours in, however many hours I'm in now, I played a decent amount of it. It's I don't want to say she's grown on me, but I will say she's less obnoxious than she was early game, and I think that's just because
she grows on you.
Well, I don't, like I said, I don't think, I think honestly, if you compare some of the earlier scenes to like where I, at least where I'm at now, like she is like way more obnoxious in the beginning of the game. Like she's very fucking like screechy and loud and like over the top. And as the game has gone on, she's gotten less of that. So now I'm like, okay, this is not that bad.
Could just be, you know, like Stockholm Syndrome.
It could be. Sure, you know,
like,
why not?
Like, you know what? Prompto's not that bad anymore. Just saying.
He ends his comment by saying, in all seriousness, her voice will grow on you after a while. If you can't get through the if you can get through hours of Vanille's voice in Final Fantasy 13, you can get through Chie's.
What if but I couldn't?
Didn't. Yeah, most people could not get through Chie through Vanille's voice in 13.
Her name is Vanille.
Yep.
Yeah. Next comes from Mikey JB. He has two comments. I'm going to read the Dishonored related one.
Okay.
He says, save scumming.
What's wrong with it?
I don't mind save scumming in Dishonored, especially with the high-low chaos feature they have. If you are playing stealthy in this game, you are most likely going for the low chaos ending. And I just don't like the fact that you can make a simple mistake that will lead to the death of 10 guards, like Crispy at the Wall of Light. Yes, I played Thief without save scumming because when I did fuck up and have to kill people, it didn't have any effect on the rest of the game. I totally agree.
I think
with.
It depends on the game, yeah.
I think I'm still low chaos, though. Like, my save still says, because I didn't, like, kill those guys. They were just like, hey, fuck you, and they killed themselves.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, they did run through the Wall of Light voluntarily.
Right? And they watched each other do it, too, and still decided to try it.
That just sounds like natural selection.
Yeah, that's like, that's the lowest of chaos.
I mean, it doesn't bother me that much.
That's a system of chaos. Like, refining itself into order.
The thing is, you can start that game off being super, like, violent and, like, going high chaos, but if you suddenly change your playstyle, like, halfway through and do the rest of the game stealthy, mm-hmm. you still readjust. Have a chance of bringing it back from the verge mm-hmm. of high chaos. It's yeah. just, you know, it does kind of suck. Especially if you're looking at it from a mission-by-mission basis, where you want to play a mission and you want to be low chaos. One fuck up can essentially ruin their
There's still plenty of ways to like he's saying, try to play stealthy and still fuck it up, especially when they're leaving like fucking whale oil barrels around everywhere.
Mm.
You try to shoot somebody with a sleeping
Which
dart.
Which turns out, I guess in Dishonored 2, those barrels are far more volatile
very fragile.
Than they are in Dishonored 1. I played a little Dishonored 1 this week. I had a situation where I was, based on what I saw in Dishonored 2, I was like, holy shit, that's going to explode. Never happened.
Let me ask you something.
No.
Dishonored 2.
Yes.
Well, I guess we'll talk about it. Emily's grappling hook, do y'all use it as a grappling hook?
Her shadow pole?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What? I mean, yeah. It's not a grappling hook. Like, when I think of grappling hooks, I think of, like, swinging. So I don't, I mean.
It's not really.
It's more of a hook shot.
But
more,
you can use it to fling yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can.
But
theoretically, you could do it perpetually, too.
If you're looking like, up and you
can you like fling to reach another point to fling off of, like it's technically possible,
probably.
Right?
I think I've done one fling is like the most I've done.
But that's what I'm saying. Like you get this skill that lets you slow down time while you're in the air. Could you like fling?
Probably.
Because I've always used it like wait till the point where it turns into like basically blink and it just gets me up on a corner of something. But
that's how I usually use it.
But maybe we're doing it wrong.
Maybe we gotta look up
I
those
mean, the
pro
one,
strats.
The one thing about Dishonored
that's what I'm waiting for, like the speed run
later
thing.
On.
Oh, yeah. The thing is, the thing about Dishonored, just as a series in general, like you ask if you can do that. I feel like there's nothing that I have thought about when in the while I'm playing a Dishonored game that I didn't realize I could do. Like, I never, like, I wonder
we're,
if I can do that.
We're so far
if
off
If you can
the
find
feedback.
A way to do it, yeah. like, if you can make the physics work for you, you can do it.
Let's save Dishonored talk for the Dishonored
Yeah, we'll
talk.
Talk
Going
about
back to his feedback or his comment, save scumming, I think it just depends on the game.
I just fucking hate the feeling of doing it. I feel dirty.
Well, I don't. And it also depends on, the game, and it depends on what I'm playing it on. If I'm playing it on PC and it loads within fucking seconds, I don't mind as much. If I'm playing on, like, a console and it takes, like, 45 seconds to reload, like, fuck that.
Dishonored's not bad at all, especially with that quick load feature they added in 2.
But you know what really sucks? Playing the game, getting, like, one of those weird little mistakes that, like, you probably maybe couldn't have even helped.
Mm-hmm.
fucking up your whole thing and then feeling like you have to go back and redo everything.
Yeah.
Like redo the whole level. Fuck that, man.
On the flip side of that same coin,
who's got time?
When you fuck up and then you just have like a, you, like, you just react and like take dudes, like I had so, like, several situations throughout that game where, like, something went wrong, a dude spotted me or something, or someone I didn't know was there saw me do something, and I reacted, and I didn't even think about it, and then I ended up taking out a dude, and then, like, went, like, I managed to make it through without alerting everyone or without setting off alarms, and, like, that stuff, like, when that kind of stuff happened and it didn't, like, bring fucking hell down on me,
yeah.
I just rolled with it.
That's the cool
stuff.
Because
it felt natural. Though. It's when you start fucking shit up and all of a sudden there's alarms going off, there's dogs coming out of the woodwork, like all that shit.
Yeah, when you find yourself like having to just stand in the corner and murder everybody in the level as they come to you.
Yeah.
And then complete your objective.
Which then makes it really easy to progress. Yeah. Our next one comes from Scarecrow. It says, Brad nailed one thing that bothered me about the first Dishonored game that's made a return in Dishonored 2. I dislike the mana system they have, especially when playing on harder difficulties. It's annoying how when you keep using your abilities, it eventually depletes that bar to a point where you can only use blink.
Yeah. I mean, exactly. You put cool abilities in your game, just let the player use them. Design around it, you know? Like, imagine if Titanfall, you had a meter to manage the ledge you ran on walls. You know, that would suck ass.
It's weird because it seems like that meter is constructed in a way where, like, you use an ability, it drains the meter, but if you don't use anything right away, it can fill back up. But if you do use it, you permanently lose all of that. So it seems like that is a system specifically designed to slow you down.
Designed
to make you like stop between moves, which I don't know if
another frustrating thing with games like that when they limit you to mana, but you can find mana recovery items. I hate that they limit me to like a minimum or like so few
you can only
mana
carry
recovery.
10.
Yeah, you know, you can only have 10. Why? Yeah. Why the fuck? I can fucking blink through the air and do all this shit. How come I can only carry 10 of something?
It's like you have a mode in the game that is a no power mode. Like if, I don't know, if you're going to make me choose between playing the game with powers and no powers, make the powers just like powerful.
All powers.
You know, just make them,
no powers, how about all powers? It's just like, use unlimited power.
Just like whatever.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
the challenge isn't in, I don't know.
All right. We have a lot to talk about. I think we should probably cut the feedback there because we do have a lot to discuss tonight. But if there's anything that we discuss on this episode that you guys want to chime in on, leave a comment on the post on 4playernetwork.com. And at the start of next week's show, we'll read some of your comments and react to them. But we have a lot of new stuff to talk about tonight. We got Final Fantasy 15, Watch Dogs 2, Pokemon, more Persona. There's a lot to talk about. I don't know where y'all want to start.
No.
The Yakuza 6 demo.
Wait, did you play that?
Yeah, but we don't have to talk about it. It's pretty cool.
All right.
I don't care. Flip a coin.
Yeah, they figured it out.
I mean, we should just start with the big one.
Let's start with the big one. Final Fantasy 15.
Persona?
Oh, fine.
Oh, fuck you, no.
Start with the 10-year-old game.
Final 15. I can't speak tonight. Final Fantasy 15.
Final 5, Fantasy 10.
Is a thing.
This is the 10-year-old game, Crispy.
This game was announced before PS3 was out.
Yep. This is technically... You know.
Versus 13?
Versus 13.
Can you... Okay, first of all, before we...
What's the real Final Fantasy 15? Somebody's working on that.
Probably.
I mean, 16 now.
The crazy thing is, like, not only are we playing Final Fantasy 15 right now, but, like, within a week... It took 10 years to actually get this thing out.
Mm-hmm.
And within a week of the release of this, we're getting The Last Guardian, which is also in the same fucking boat.
Speaking of, like, 10 years...
And then Prey 2...
Like, remember Final Fantasy VII? It sort of, like, popularized the console RPG in the West.
Yes,
right?
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
It was a big deal. And you know what? A year and a half later, 8 came out. And a year and a half later, 9 came out. And a year and a half later, 10 came out. What the fuck happened to Square?
They used to be Squaresoft.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. And then they did a movie.
Mm-hmm. And then they did a movie.
Yeah, they put...
Nothing was going
What are you doing here?
Don't bother. Don't mind this footage.
So the chocobos
should have started
anywhere.
Like a minute in.
To answer your question, they put too much in the Final Fantasy 13 basket. Like they put too much you know.
Yeah. I mean, somebody came up with this whole like Nova Chrysalia thing, and they're like, yes, throw all of our money at that for like the next 10 years.
See, Nick would just have thrown away this footage.
I would have. I absolutely would
He's
have.
He's so picky about more his belts.
Dude, oh my God.
Dude, it's getting better right now.
Just watch. You'll see in a little bit when we eventually roll my Pokemon footage, the first thing I fucking do is I put out a Pokemon that's weak against the fucking...
Great.
Anyway. I hate recording footage. Anyway,
Final Fantasy 15.
Final Fantasy 15. It's out. It's in the wild. It's a real thing.
Did you take Noctis' jacket off, I say?
Yes.
Good call. Good call.
The thing is...
First of all, who here watched
He still
the
looks like a fucking goober.
Stuff?
I did.
Oh, I didn't watch the Brotherhood stuff.
I watched Brotherhood and Kingsglaive last night.
I want to. I want to watch Brotherhood.
Wait, Brotherhood, I enjoy Brotherhood far more than Kingsglaive.
Oh, I didn't know there was
There's a four episode?
Five.
Five episodes.
It's an anime minutes. Thing. It's kind of like a background of each of his friends.
It's about an hour and 5 minutes long. So I watched
So it's like everything that Kingsglaive isn't about?
Yes. Yes.
Prompt.
Honestly, like, so I got the collector's edition of Final Fantasy 15.
No, you
didn't. I know. I got
the collector's edition.
I got the middle one. And it came
what
with
it,
oh. It came with the Blu-ray of Kingsglaive, and after I watched Brotherhood, I was like, I kind of wish it came with the Blu-ray of Brotherhood instead.
The thing is, Square Enix done goofed, and they sent me my copy on Saturday.
Yeah, what the fuck happened?
So I've had it since Saturday, yet Brad's already farther than me, but I guess he did play.
Oh, yeah.
I did have to, like, work and stuff.
I did an absurd
There's, like, a statue or something.
I took the day off work today, and none of you fuckers decided to text me and tell me to not do anything... No side quests until you get chocobos.
I mentioned it in Discord.
So I sat here all day doing side quests without chocobos.
Yo, that car's the pits.
Okay. Let's talk about
about the car.
Hold on, let's mention that real quick. If you haven't played yet or you just started or whatever, stop what you're doing. Just do the main story missions until you unlock chocobos and then you can go back and do whatever. Trust me, no matter what.
How far is that?
Like, it's only like 4 or 5 story missions. It's not that far.
Wait,
just do the main story missions.
Man, I
unlock
played for
chocobos.
7 hours today, and the fact that I haven't done 4 golden. Story missions.
Don't do it. Leave the hinterlands, Nick.
Yeah, that is true.
Oh, I guess that is kind of what I'm
don't
doing.
Don't do that.
Sorry.
But you got a fish.
So
a little cat.
Before we start talking about mechanics,
get him a fish.
Speaking, mm-hmm. I feel like it is Final Fantasy, so I feel like it's kind of worth mentioning. Like going into this. I was a little skeptical, especially seeing that it was originally a Final Fantasy 13 game.
It was a spin-off.
It was a spin-off of Final Fantasy 13,
like a dirge of Cerberus.
Yes,
like, you know, traditional Final Fantasy.
And they completely retconned that and just made it into a new, completely original Final Fantasy. So, like, I was skeptical that they were going to be able to make a story that was cohesive enough or worthwhile enough to like.
Well, you know, Prompto's a foul sea, right?
Shut up! God damn it! Shut up! But one thing I wanted to say, because the big thing going into this, I know you have no idea what the fuck you're
talking
about.
I didn't get that at all.
No, because you didn't play Final Fantasy 13. The point I wanted to make was that going into this, I was pretty skeptical. First of all, I've been very like, I can't believe there's no ladies in the team. It's just a bunch of dudes.
No, I agree.
I know, but like now that I've kind of see. Like the context of the story they're trying to tell.
You realize
it's
Ignis is kind of the lady.
It's essentially like a bachelor party. Like his friends are guiding him to like take him to get married.
Yep.
Which, you know, and then some crazy shit happens. Yeah. And you know,
you mean Kingsglaive happens.
Kingsglaive, yeah, that's the crazy shit.
I'm gonna say this: if anybody's kind of thinking about watching this, I don't care what you do or how you get a hold of it, but you have to watch Kingsglaive. Otherwise, the story doesn't have any.
The two don't make sense without each other, really. Like,
which sucks.
Like,
because
you
Kings
can't
Glaive...
watch the movie and then not play the game, and then you can't play the game without watching the movie and really understand what the fuck's going on. Because even when they explain it all, it doesn't make any fucking
sense.
And
sadly, you have to do that, even though Kingsglaive, to me, represents everything I hate about what Final Fantasy has become over the years.
There's some cool cutscenes.
Yeah, sure. I guess. Sorry. That movie looked incredible, and the voice acting was not... terrible, except for that one character.
The
Which character?
The dagger-throwing teleportation choreography was pretty good.
Yeah, it was really fun. Good. That was great.
The one character I'm referring like to is his friend who breaks
you know
his
what?
Leg or whatever.
No.
Oh, yeah.
No.
I couldn't stand his voice.
I'm going to say this
Liberatus?
Right. No.
Yes.
I'm going to say this right now, because I agree that Kingsglaive is a mess, but I'm telling you right now,
it's
like Nyx? Nyx?
That Nyx, wasn't yeah, Nyx.
Nyx and his,
not
like,
me.
And his, like, crew?
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, I would probably rather the play Kings, a game they were more with the Kingsglaive. They're more interesting characters than these.
I agree. I'm sitting there watching Kingsglaive going, why is everything in this world like so fucking cool except for the main characters of the game? Like, they are the only thing that doesn't look awesome so far.
Now,
stuffy world, okay, like, you know, I mean.
Now, here's the thing. Like, awesome, yes, maybe. Like Nyx is a... it was a pretty badass character.
Well, I mean, the whole concept of the Kingsglaive was really cool. Like,
mm-hmm. I like the conceit of the game itself. Like, these four friends, this prince and who is
there's
who's
no,
kind
no,
of
no, no, for sure.
There's nothing wrong for with sure. four friends going on an adventure. Yeah. Blah blah
no, no,
blah.
No, that's
like,
that's great.
Like Brad was saying, the characters in the movie, even though we only saw them for like fucking maybe a grand total of 40 minutes, like, were so much more interesting and had so much more potential than these characters.
Well, I mean, I would narrow that down a little bit too into saying that like. I think the main party, like, they all kind of have well-defined personalities, and you kind of get, like, what archetypes they are all supposed to be. Like, they all read very well, mm-hmm. except for Noctis.
Yeah,
and I get that he's the main character, so they try to make him more of, like, a fucking blank slate, but, like, any time, like, a character's talking to Noctis, it's just kind of like...
Sure. Ugh. Crispy, on that note, I would say watch Brotherhood.
Yeah.
Because Brotherhood does a lot to kind of explain where he's coming from and what his character actually is. Because they don't do it, which is funny because...
What his personality
like,
is?
He has like, more of a person... It's funny because his whole thing in Brotherhood is that he is kind of this like spoiled prince. He's kind of who feels like he's being forced to kind of learn to take care of himself, and he's being resistant to that. And he doesn't have a really like bombastic personality like the other guys in his group,
mm-hmm.
But it's still a personality, and you get that in Brotherhood. They haven't really done much of that in the game itself yet.
They do a little bit of it.
A little bit.
Where
of it.
You kind of have these little like one-on-one moments. Because
like some like, of the story missions in Brotherhood, yeah. Ignis is trying to teach him how to cook for himself.
No. Oh, he and does. He so there is, and so that's what I kind of want to talk
about.
He's
being a picky eater
in this game.
Like that. Gladio teaches him how to fight.
Similar. Yeah. I mean, Brad said, "Get out of the hinterlands," but that's not far from the truth. That there are some definitely moments between the characters that randomly happen. You're driving in a car, have a conversation. There's one morning when you're camping and you wake up, and Ignis is like, or night before, Ignis is like, "Hey, we're gonna wake up and we're gonna cook breakfast together tomorrow."
Yeah.
And like, there's some stuff like that happens in between the characters. It actually is. I want more of it. I guess.
Yeah.
It happens more the farther I get in the game.
Yeah, I'm hoping that the potential that I see is going to like blossom.
Yeah.
Per se, you know,
like
what I mean?
A real bromance.
Yeah, exactly. Like I feel like the characters in Kingsglaive had a lot of potential, but I feel like maybe they were.
I'm just
maybe
saying, like that
were, like,
story,
accessories to the...
that story in that setup, and like kind of what. Nyx and his buddies were,
mm-hmm.
but like that seems like a more interesting like base to tell like a grand story.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
to be honest.
Right.
True.
Well, yeah.
Not that. And I'll say this: I think the best part of this game is, you know, the buddies.
Yeah.
You know, is
but it
is that
looks
chemistry.
Like, and it looks like I like there's that little bit of foreshadowing at the very beginning of the game. You remember.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it kind of, like, if that's any indication, it looks
like
this is going to be a pretty huge arc for these characters.
Yeah. And it implies they eventually get to that point where they maybe
yeah,
are more
where, like, they're
the
those guys.
Yeah.
Like,
they
yeah.
become, like, Nyx and his crew kind of
yeah.
at some
yeah.
point. But I kind of brought it up just because, you know, for me, story has always been a big deal in Final Fantasy, and, like, I was not expecting much from this, but I'm actually surprised by how much I'm enjoying these characters
yeah
quite a bit so
the characters yes the, but oh. the overall story
I mean it's still early we're it, all still yeah. early
sort of I mean
been,
I'm not that early
I've been reading a lot of that in reviews though is that the story never really gets that deep like
yeah.
they set a lot of it up and then it kind of just stays there most of the time
gotcha.
So I don't know like how much of that's going to be pulling me through. I think the world is really cool. I think the initial setup, once you kind of understand the conflicts and the powers involved, which I'm not entirely sure that I do fully yet, but certain aspects of, like, the political makeup of this world, I think are really cool. Like you have that whole empire that's been whittled down to that one last city, and they've given up all of their territory to the enemy, and yet you still have, like, their like, the Kingsglaive is, like, their main, like, badass special missions force, but it's all made up of people from territories that they've, like, given up and
yeah.
said, like, fuck your home, but you're still gonna fight for the capital
yeah.
city. Like, shit like that's really cool.
It's pretty well thought out, and I'm wondering how much of that was developed or... for when this game when it was still Versus. I wonder if we'll ever find out how different this is from what Versus 13 was.
They've touched on that.
Because, like,
is this supposed to be the same world? Like,
and it, what, 13?
13 versus yeah.
the same universe.
It's all retcon.
Same, this but was I mean, originally it, going. No, no.
But it's also. But, like, Final Fantasy Type Zero is also the same.
It was. Going
all
to
that
be.
Shit's retcon.
This yeah. has been. Really? This is no longer officially part of the 13 world. But before, it was going to be.
Really?
Which is weird. But, like, if you look at the original trailer for Versus 13, like, from 10 years ago. You see Noctis. Looked, you see yeah. King Regis. You see the fucking swords flying
yeah,
around.
And those are just models.
You see
that
the
they,
car.
They, yeah, I mean,
like,
they
concepts.
Changed the lady.
Yeah.
They changed right. the lady. Like, it's just, I'm wondering if we'll ever find out what exactly changed, story, maybe from a story perspective, from the very beginning.
Can I pose a question to the group?
Sure.
Because I'm interested about opinions, because I'm still unsure how I feel about this. What do you guys think of the combat system and... Are you using the wait mode or just like the pure active
mode? See, I tweeted about that earlier because I was originally, I've been using active mode, mm-hmm. but in the training I did the wait mode a little bit and I was like, you know, the combat system early on is it feels really clusterfucky,
mm-hmm.
especially until you start to get better at dodging and handling big groups of enemies.
Mm-hmm.
So I had posed the question to y'all about mm-hmm. whether or not y'all are using wait mode, and everyone seemed to say that wait mode actually kind of
makes it worse. Yeah.
So
here's my problem. So
that's fine.
So first of all, the combat I still think could use lots of improvement. Mm. I think there's definitely issues with it. The camera gets fucky. I don't like that I can't just lock on to an enemy and stay locked onto them until they are dead. Oh I hate God. That if they go out of my view, it just automatically locks onto another.
Fighting
no,
that behemoth.
No, if I'm fighting 30 enemies, there are times when I'm fighting a bunch of enemies. I don't want to take them all out. Like a little bit of health here, a little health here. I want to take out one at a time. Just one at a time, just whittle them down. But since they're constantly moving around, I'm constantly having to refine the one I was... And that is super fucking frustrating.
Well, it's like they want you to just fucking like warp around the entire fucking battle.
I understand.
I mean,
yeah, but then you run out of...
If there's a rock nearby.
Yeah, if there's a rock nearby, you can warp up to, yeah. But, so the wait mode, my problem with the wait mode is I don't feel like it's what I want it to be.
Is it only stopping time when you're not moving?
Yes.
It does, but it's like if you're not performing an action or pushing the stick, it freezes it, but only for a limited time. There's like a meter that burns.
So it's like 2 minutes. What I want wait mode to be is I want to press a button and have everything stop.
Yeah.
And then I want to make a decision, and then I want to continue playing.
Like, which would be kind of like Final Fantasy 12, right?
Yeah, no, exactly. Yeah. Exactly what 12 does. As soon as you press a button in 12, everything stops. You make the decision, and then it continues going. And that's what I want from this wait mode. And this wait mode, like, I'm always confused as to how exactly to get it to stop. Like, I know as soon as you stop moving, I understand that.
But it seems
like,
random. Like, sometimes it stops instantly, sometimes.
It takes a few seconds.
Yeah, it's tied to animations. It's not good. It definitely feels tacked on. And probably there is so this thing's been in development for 10 years. They've retooled this combat system and changed and added stuff like probably three different times
in the
last
year. Yeah, they've changed a lot.
That shows a lack of confidence. And I feel like that wait mode is something that was tacked on maybe in response to like the Dusuke demo, the first demo.
And so I think the problem with the Dusuke demo is that similar to anybody who starts this game is that combat can be very confusing early on. And that can get people flustered, and maybe it's too fast-paced, and so they're like, oh, let's add this wait mode to slow things down for people. The problem with that is the wait mode wasn't implemented very well. I don't know. I you know, being like, I don't know, maybe I'm 12 hours in, I've gotten much better at the combat now.
Yeah.
And I understand it more. Like I said, I still wish the lock-on
system... So you
want to
answer a question for me then?
Sure.
Because I still don't quite get how it works.
Okay.
The link, what do they call them?
Link, whatever. Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Link attacks.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Is it just when you do an attack and you're near another person? And
so yes and no. So yeah, depending on where you are, what move you're doing, and in relation to other people, yes, that will change things up. And it also depends on if you're parrying an enemy versus attacking them from behind.
I mean, I found an enemy. It was like a flying bird enemy, and it said, and it gave me like a random. I never seen this happen before. It gave me like a challenge where it was like,
okay,
do
yeah,
two
yeah.
link attacks mm-hmm. on this animal, and I was like, mm-hmm. okay, how?
So the best way to get a link attack is to either A, get a back attack on the enemy when your teammate is near you.
The blind side, right?
A blind side, yeah. So if you're behind them. Or to parry the enemy when your teammate is near you. If you do a parry and a counter and your teammate is near you, it will usually do a combo parry move, yeah. Which is actually really cool because they're unique for like every enemy, yeah. Which is actually really interesting because there are so many different moves and stuff you can end up doing.
I'll say this right now. The fucking animations in this game are insane.
You know what's insane in this game? The fucking enemy design. Yeah. Like, holy shit, some of the enemies in this game are so goddamn unique and interesting. I just wish... like combat was better, like so I could see what's going on.
You wish
on.
It looked like this and played like Dragon's Dogma.
Exactly.
If I can climb on that behemoth like I could in Dragon's Dogma. Yeah.
So, but by the way, cool. What you're watching here is me doing a ridiculous fucking mission in which I'm trying to find like essentially bear traps, but they are a little too well hidden. Like it takes me an absurd amount of time to find these fucking traps. This is like a random like side mission I'm doing. But anyway, so...
Can I say something else about the combat system? It's that I feel like you eventually get to the point, you know, you work your way down the skill trees where you start getting some interesting skills, especially the skills that you do with your teammates using the technique bar.
Yeah, the techniques
are cool. The only thing is there's some really interesting skills that are tied to that you could actually use to strategize, but they all pull from the same meter. So I find myself just using Ignis's heal the most because... it doesn't matter what you do, how much defense you have, everything in this game hits like a truck. So if you get hit, you need to heal. You know, I've never like the things will hit you for half health all the time, no matter what you're fighting. So I'm always using, and this is me with all defensive items on. I'm always using Ignis's ability while like Prompto has like this really cool gravity bomb pulls all enemies in towards you. Kind of like the gravity arrow from Dragon's Dogma. You combine that with like magic spells, you're doing crazy damage. Yeah. But I'm always using at the point heal. Where I'm like, well, I gotta use this fucking heal, his regroup.
You gotta not get hit as much.
Well, wait, when you say you're shit using, gets chaotic.
Hold on. When you say you're using Ignis's heal, are you saying that's a technique?
That's a technique. Yeah, you press L1, and then you, depending on what, so you can have him learn a technique.
And I've been experimenting with that today.
So as soon as you unlock that, use it quite a bit. And so that's what I also tell people is use the techniques as much as you can. Because the thing is, they level up and become better. And if you don't use them in combat, it's not like you store up that technique level. Just as soon as that bar is filled, just use it.
I wish they had their own meters or something.
Yeah, I agree. What I wanted to say is something I wanted to call out, and I've seen myself do it like 20 times in this footage.
You ever going to fight anything in this footage?
Yeah, I will. Okay. I am extremely frustrated that the jump button and the interact button are the same fucking button.
Oh, how many times have you run up to something and just started like jumping? You're like, you go to talk to somebody and you're just like,
I wish I could compile the 12 hours I've played this game of me trying to mount my chocobo and just jumping up and down next to it. Because like the problem is you'll jump and it'll show the mount button, so you'll press it again, but that will trigger like another jump animation. Like it is so infuriating that is the same. I don't understand. I really don't.
It's a lot of weird decisions. Like when you get on the chocobo,
what do you do with triangle?
The
in
jump
this game?
Is different.
What nothing?
It doesn't fucking do anything.
Nothing.
Why can't
this? Wait. That's not true.
No, triangle warp. In combat is your warp.
Is your warp.
Oh,
what do you do with it outside of combat?
You can
Brad?
Sometimes warp, but it's very inconsistent.
Well, how often do you interact and jump?
Well.
Why can't those be two fucking different buttons?
Why is the chocobo's jump different than the humans?
So that's another frustration.
It doesn't even make sense.
So y'all aren't there yet. In running around, X is jump, but when you're on a chocobo, circle is jump.
What?
Yeah, it's kind of fucking silly.
So I feel like that. I feel like when it's all said and done, and we've played this game for 100 hours, we're gonna look back at it and say
there's zero.
Say
combat.
That like the biggest problem with this game is there's an inconsistency in like
And a little bit.
And some of the design choices.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, for sure. There's zero combat on chocobos, though?
Correct.
You get abilities for your chocobos that you can, like...
If you aren't a chocobo and combat starts, you get off and the chocobo runs away.
I just
want
to be like a chocobo knight.
Unfortunately,
like, No. You'll eventually get, like, chocobo kick or something?
Also...
So that's almost like a technique. You can use it in battle, you can press a button, and you can call your chocobo, and it will come in and attack enemies.
But no chocobo combat. Like,
correct.
Right. No mounted combat. No.
Which would be too awesome, you know?
So,
whoa, pump the brakes on the awesome there for a second.
They
okay?
had that in, and then they removed it. Because they're like, let's
just
not
make it like mountain.
Let's not get crazy here.
But that means
couch your
if you
your king weapon.
Did anybody play the arcade? Or the pinball.
It is a piece of shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Monster mm-hmm. 4, Monster Free, Monster Justice 5.
I had no idea what was
going on. Yeah, you have no idea what was going on. So the thing is,
I started to figure
it
out. Hold
on, the thing is, I downloaded the game when it came out on Android, and I played it. I played it for maybe, I don't know, like an hour. And it's the same game. It's the same game, but the problem is I just don't think it's I don't think it's like good enough for to warrant me playing it. It is no triple triad.
Well, I don't.
I got a high potion.
You can't listen to the triple triad music in your car.
So that's what I will say to everyone. That is the only reason to ever be in the car is because of all the Final Fantasy music. And when you play this game, every time you go to a shopkeeper, buy the final because you have to buy them from different people, but they're only like 100 gil.
Yeah,
so it's
bullshit.
Well worth
why can't you just have an MP3
dude,
player?
I'll tell you what's
I always have to listen to the Chocobo theme on a Chocobo. That's it's true. Such a bummer.
You know, it's crazy. It's funny. Like I've just kind of like
you got to get.
I love Final Fantasy music. Like, I love it. I have so many of the soundtracks. The ironic thing is I've been driving around this game for the most part listening to the Final Fantasy 13 soundtrack.
Oh, it is a good soundtrack.
It's a good soundtrack, and it's just funny because it just used to be a Final Fantasy 13 game, quote unquote. Can we talk about the best part of this game though?
No.
What's that?
The fucking food.
The bros.
Dude,
I like the menu. I like how like your menu is just Ignis like sitting there thinking, and then when you pick something, he's like, "Yep, that's what I'm gonna make."
I
the first time that happened, I was like, "Dad, I mean, it was really late, and I was really tired, and I wasn't thinking right, but I got a nice chocolate."
Also, every time you pick food, and then it shows him like putting it on the table,
it looks so delicious.
Delicious.
How much time did they spend on this food?
Some of it looks photorealistic, but if you look close enough, you realize it's not.
Yeah.
It's not a photo. You're like, oh my God. Oh my God. Delicious.
I mean, that was the last 2 years of development was just them working on the food.
If you like food, I recommend Vanillaware games and Yakuza.
Dude, Muramasa.
Yeah.
This game was giving me Muramasa flashbacks.
That's every Vanillaware game.
I loved Muramasa specifically because of the fucking food.
I was playing the Yakuza 6 demo today, and they've gone all out, but with, like, real actual brands.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you, like, select your drink, he actually holds it in his hand, and you press a button to lift it to your lips. And as it gets close, he starts to pucker. And, like, the animation for drinking is the best I've ever seen in a video game. And his head kind of does an idle animation, and depending on where his head is, he'll still bring the drink to his lips. It's... like hours,
because Adam's apple goes
months
like,
went into this drink animation. It's crazy.
Never talked about the car.
The car. So here, the car early on, it gets slightly better. So early on, the frustrating thing is during the day you can't drive it manually. You have to auto drive everywhere. And at nighttime, you have to drive manually.
Hold on.
Yes.
No. You can drive manually
during the day. You can.
It gets unlocked at a certain point.
Okay,
at the very beginning,
every single time I've tried to drive like manually during the day, it's told me it's been grayed out.
Yeah,
I've already like that's all I've done so far.
You can steer when Ignis is driving. By the way,
yeah, you can.
So it's like, and because driving is not even really a fucking thing, it's the same shit.
Yeah,
you can tell him when to turn around, and you can steer it. So it's like you're driving.
It is like you're driving.
The car is weird.
It's terrible.
The frustrating thing is it's the fact that. Every time it's nighttime and you go to drive, you have to have that fucking little animation with Ignis telling you, "Oh, you shouldn't drive at night."
There's a lot of shit like that when you're like refilling gas.
Yeah. Gas animations. No, and so that's that. Okay. So sorry, I wrote a bunch of stuff down and I forgot it at home. But yes, thank you for saying that. Everything in this game is fucking slow. Getting in and out of the car is slow. Talking to someone at a restaurant is slow. Like it's just like there are so many things that take up so much.
It's
fucking
because they want
time.
Those animations look good.
They do look good. Like you said, filling up gas takes so long. Like I freaked out here because this bomb thing came out of nowhere. Like stuff popping up at night.
And the birds just scatter.
Yeah. The birds just fucking get the fuck out. But yeah, no, everything in this game is slow. Like I said, I hate walking up to like a quest giver, pressing X, and then having to wait like 15 seconds before you actually get into the menu to where you can start doing things. Like, I don't understand.
15 seconds?
It's pretty, okay, so it's not 50, it's like 5 seconds. But it's like we were saying when we were talking about like that seeming like an eternity when you're doing it so often.
Yeah.
It just, that adds up over time, and it's just frustrating.
It's gonna be, it's... It, the game itself, like when you look back at the experience is going to be kind of
by the time I finish this game, I'm not going to care about that. But in the moment, I do. And the other thing I wanted to say about driving around at nighttime is I hate that at the beginning of the game. And that's why I wanted to say, that's why I said go get the chocobo first. That's what you can do at nighttime. Because when you're driving at nighttime and those fucking like giants will start popping up in the road, essentially stopping you from driving because the car just stops and you have to get out and you can't do anything. And so that's why I was saying, like, just get to the chocobos as fast as possible so you can use them as much as you want at night. And eventually, I just got there yesterday, actually like 10 minutes after recording this footage. Ignis had a conversation with me, and it's like, oh, your strength is high enough that Ignis trusts you, and you can actually do the auto drive at nighttime. You don't have to drive manually. So eventually that unlocks.
How does that unlock?
It said something about strength. I don't know exactly what it was that triggered it, but
it's the car. It's one of those things that, you know, they obviously wanted to include it in the game because they want to give you that sense of like road tripping kind of thing, but they didn't want to give you full control of a car. Yeah. So as a result, you end up with a lot of really weird design choices that have to do with this car.
You can't crash it unless you're like trying to make a decision on where to turn, and then you just wreck your car. Have you ever done that?
No.
Oh my god! You turn by going to a point and like just hold the stick to the right. Yeah. But if you change it the last second to the left, the car will kind of go and just run into the wall, and like the whole body of the car just gets dented, and all the windows get shattered.
And then you have to take
it all the way back to Hammerhead, have her fix it.
Yeah.
Or you're just stuck like that forever.
Yeah.
That's
the only way to crash.
I wish the car was better because I like the customization of it. I like the fact
that... The idea is...
I have a car covered in fucking like chocobos. There's like chocobos all over the car, and I like that you can change the color and all. And you can do so much, but then I don't. The interior, yeah, I love that. That's so customizable, but then I don't ever fucking want to be in.
They fucked up because it's a great idea, but it's, you know.
It's probably the worst part of the game.
Yeah, I think so. And that's why you have to rush to get the chocobos, because doing all these fucking side quests, running around, especially because he can't even really sprint that long. Getting anywhere sucks
ass.
The
fact that there is stamina in this game is goddamn frustrating. Sense, and that's why I enabled that stamina bar.
I've updated to the point where I can run for quite a while.
Yeah, but you can update your stamina?
Yeah, it's one of the stats.
That's so dumb.
But it doesn't matter because you should never go anywhere not on a chocobo.
That's why I enabled that stamina thing, because it's annoying that it's there. But as soon as it gets low, I just start rolling until it refills, and then I run again.
And when you're in towns, you can't
run. The game doesn't tell you. If you're sprinting and you, I had the stamina bar visible as well. But if you're sprinting and you're watching your stamina bar go down, if you let go of the sprint button right before you run out of all your stamina, it'll flash green and it'll refill your stamina.
There's a fucking action like trigger.
Yeah, it doesn't tell you. It'll completely refill your stamina like that.
I've seen the green
running thing. So you can just turn that bar.
What do you have to do?
Oh, I didn't fucking know that.
You have to, while you're holding the button to sprint.
You have to wait till the meter
is almost empty, like literally like a shrivel left, and then let go, and it will like you'll flash green and your bar will fill all the way back up.
That's bullshit.
Instantly.
I wish I would have fucking known.
They don't tell you.
I just wish I could throw that sword outside of battle, like effectively. He has this cool. I mean, you watch Kingsglaive and he's throwing and teleporting to his
blade. You can.
All over the some of the time, maybe.
Okay.
It's very inconsistent.
I will say this. I remember doing that like in the Final Fantasy 15 demo. Remember where you could go to the top of that building?
Yeah.
Like, that was completely outside of combat, and that was super simple. So I'm wondering if there's something that was unlocked there that we don't have yet that makes that super easy.
I think they had to dial it back. I think a lot of this stuff may be planned to be a little more open and free form, like his warp ability, but then they just had to dial it back because, you know, I could see how that was potentially causing issues. And it's really frustrating because, you know, you see something like blink. Imagine if you could only blink to like certain spots in any given area, that would be so lame, you know. I can't get mad at it because, you know, the game still feels very nice and open and
dude, the world is fucking huge,
dude. It is a big world.
Yeah, I mean,
someone on Twitter. I forgot who it was.
Babe, if you zoom out, though,
I think it may have been Gray Fox. Somebody tweeted at me today and they made a good point. They said, "I love how deceptively huge the world is because." When you're looking at the map, it looks kind of small, and like especially like I bought the strategy guide because I always do it with Final Fantasy, and it came with a big map. I was like, this is it, this is the whole world map. That's kind of small, and like, but the moment you try and get out of your car and just run somewhere on foot, it takes God damn, this place is huge.
Well, you get a chocobo, it's a lot.
It gets better when you have a chocobo,
but yeah.
But no, I will say, get the chocobo as fast as you can, because the best thing about the chocobo is the fact that the more you use it, the better it gets.
Yeah,
because similar to your stamina, not even similar to your stamina, just running around on a chocobo, he will eventually start leveling up. He gets more stamina, more speed. There's a, in your skill tree, in your fucking mini sphere grids, you can get an ability that the more you ride a chocobo, you gain AP for just running around on a chocobo, which is fucking amazing because, you know, why not? It's free AP.
Hey,
did y'all know there's a dart game you can play? And if you get a bullseye, you get like 15 AP.
Nice.
Really?
Yeah, just once. Only once.
Yeah. You know, how do y'all feel about the health system in this game?
It's
because
weird.
I found myself in dungeons. Like, later on in the game, you start going into dungeons. I guess they call them kind of like
they're dungeons.
Skyrim dungeon.
They are dungeons.
I guess not like a Zelda dungeon, like a Skyrim dungeon. But,
And your health won't regen in the dungeon.
The health doesn't regen unless you use elixirs.
Yeah.
And that's a little frustrating, especially when somebody like Prompto, you know,
he has no
dies
fucking health
so fucking quickly.
Yeah.
And you do too, because you just get wailed on, and you just kind of have to use elixirs.
You know the trick, Brad?
What?
Never let go of the square button.
Well, you know, if you're playing the game right, you're holding down square, you're holding down R1, you're moving the stick, and you're pressing circle to attack.
Yeah.
I don't have four thumbs.
Yeah. Kind of. I mean, you kind of have to fucking get it right. Yeah. It's frustrating that you have to do like a weird claw and it's frustrating that once again it's another example of bad button placement.
Yeah,
you know, dodge shouldn't be a square and circle attack, because it's not that, you know, I even tried early on to time my parries or whatever. So you know, you press the square right at the last second, but I always end up getting hit. And the game even tells you, it's like, oh, just hold square.
Yeah.
The game like tells you that. And I'm like, that's so fucking silly.
You know, you could go through it all of combat by just holding down the circle button. He'll auto attack, auto face, he'll kill enemies, he'll start attacking others, he'll move towards them.
Yeah.
It's you don't even have to hold a stick.
Yeah.
You could just hold down circle. It's very kind of streamlined like that, which is kind of strange, because I feel like kind of like in maybe the first time you play Assassin's Creed, when you're coming from other video games, you're pressing more inputs than you need to, and you'll find yourself jumping off buildings because you're not simplifying it enough.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I feel like that's kind of how it works here too. You know, or I'll try to time my square when I really don't need to.
You don't need to, yeah. And I will say, in that regard, the simplification of combat, the weapons are pretty cool.
Yeah.
I like the fact that
I've
aren't limited.
Been using the royal
weapons. Yeah, I like the fact that you aren't limited to, you know, you have to use a Buster Sword or you have to use a Gunblade. I like that you can use every weapon, and so you can kind of get a feel for which ones you like. I like that enemies, are only weak to certain types of weapons, so you have to kind of figure that out.
Make sure you get Ignis's ability, this Libra ability.
I was going to ask, because right now the only way for me to see weaknesses and strengths of enemies is to do
weight mode. Yeah.
And like,
which is frustrating.
Ignis
because
has an ability that
he gets an ability, but it's since you're trying to lock on and you're losing that lock on, so you're like, wait, which one had its weaknesses? And it's going so fast. This game can get real clusterfucked.
It can.
Yeah. One thing we didn't mention at all is the magic system, which is...
It's awful.
So hold on.
Weird.
I like that I can use items to combine with magic.
I still like
to
it better than 5 Fantasy 8, to be honest.
Hold on. So far.
I
like that you can combine items with magic for different abilities, you know, cast it multiple times, you know, instead of hurting you, it will heal you.
Yeah.
You know, I like that concept. I don't like that I can only store three fucking magic things at a time.
You can boost it a little bit by investing in that tree, but like it's so... The system is so like high maintenance that I kind of don't even want to deal with it even then, because you have to go to points in the world to draw out elements, you know, from the ground to even have the energy to be able to make shit. And even then you're using depletable resources to make the ones you want. And even then it's a depletable fucking resource that you have to re-equip when it runs out. It's too like bothersome.
So Brad, I will say that, you know, to alleviate.
And
that.
It hurts you.
Yeah. Oh, well, yeah, it does.
Scared the shit out of me, Brad.
Yeah, you said a blizzard. Everyone takes is damage. Dying in the blizzard.
Yeah. It's unfortunate that your magic affects you and your teammates.
But you know what? It looks cool.
Unless
shit.
You set it to heal. But no, cool. So what I will say is, yeah, using items, you can, and you know you can add more than one item, right?
Yeah.
So you can have, instead of creating a, you know, an intensity 99 blizzard that casts three times, you can create an intensity 120 blizzard that you can cast like 15 times.
Which is cool, but the worst part about magic is, and the main reason I'm not investing in it, and I've seen stuff where I could... Like, I've envisioned in my head a way to make a really effective magic build if it wasn't so fucky. Like, for example, I found a shopkeeper that was selling mithril daggers, which you could actually buy, like, three of, equip the three, and get plus 50 to your magic three times, you know, and then have one magic spell in your magic slot. You know, and you could gear yourself out in a certain way to potentially make, like, a magic build. And I, like, using promptos, like Gravity Bomb with it, almost makes it seem like it's worth it. But the dumbest shit is that there's, no matter what the spell is, no matter how powerful it is, no matter who cast it, there's a fucking cooldown, a universal cooldown. Yeah. Anytime anybody uses magic, even your fucking teammates.
That's really dumb.
There's a cooldown. I can have three different spells equipped, but as soon as I cast one, everyone is on a cooldown. And it's a long cooldown. And I looked at that magic. I looked at every single skill on the magic bar, and there is no way to affect that cooldown.
Yeah, to decrease the cooldown. Yeah.
So it just made it trash for me, you know, to the point where, like, okay, I'll occasionally use it as a burst against, like, a tough enemy that maybe he's weak to, but I will never strategize around magic because it's fucked.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not... It's
coming from every Final Fantasy game we've ever played, magic has always played a big role in the game. And it seems like it's almost like a second thought in this game. It's you know Nick, you compared it to Final Fantasy VIII, but I would not compare it to Final Fantasy VIII.
Only because, like Final Fantasy VIII, this game treats magic like an item.
Quantifiable
item.
Correct. I mean, in VIII, it's a quantifiable item, but you can have, you know, 40 or 50 different of that quantifiable item, whereas in this, you can have three at a time.
Yeah, and that's where it's bullshit. What were you going to say, Crispy?
Oh, I was going to say, I basically what he was saying is I think there is a difference. I think the Final Fantasy VIII system kind of makes sense to me.
It's less maintenance. You're only drawing it out of them and then using it.
The other thing I was going to ask was, are there summons in the game? Are there, like, anima or anything like that?
They look cool.
Yeah.
But they're powerful, but there's not, like, strategy behind using them, you know? It's
okay, so there are summons that you use because
they were some in the demos and
looking
the,
at what I, like based on yeah, like yeah, ramen, what I've seen in the game so the far demos, like yeah. Every time I see a summon, it's like you're fighting it.
No, you use it too. Okay,
that, like,
you saw them fighting Titan,
yeah,
is what you
and
saw.
Leviathan.
Oh yeah, I guess that is true.
Like every summon I've seen in the game so far has been in a boss fight, so I was wondering if, like, the summons have been swapped and now they're just big.
It's
kind of
like a
fights.
Limit break or some shit. I mean, it's sort of like a last ditch effort, like, oh, you're dying or something, and do your summon.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give it this. Like, one thing I love and respect about Final Fantasy is that even though sometimes they miss on their combat systems, like, every single game is dramatically different from the last.
Yeah,
which is cool. So
they always try and be unique, and they always try and change things up. And it's
definitely a hit or miss situation here. Yeah. I think they hit more in this than they did in 13.
Oh, definitely. I will say, you know, I've bitched a lot about this game, and it has a lot of issues that I hope they fix in patches that would be easily fixable. That being said, like, I want to go home and play it right now.
Yeah, me too.
Like, so I am playing it on the PS4 Pro. Nick and I are playing it on the Pro.
Have you is that?
There is one setting for high resolution or low resolution, and it essentially is not great frame rate and worse frame rate. This game does not have the best frame rate.
No, the disparity in, like, the visual
is
like
not
graphics
worth it.
Between light and high resolution is not big enough to warrant.
I mean, maybe
this
on a 4K display. I don't even think maybe not.
I was looking.
I tried to play it on Black Friday.
I didn't do it.
I tried to play this on high resolution, and the frame rate definitely takes a pretty decent drop. Yeah. And I couldn't tell.
Not
the
to the point where it's unplayable.
Yeah. But the it image was still quality.
But knowing that you could just take a tiny, tiny visual dip and have a better frame rate is just too enticing.
Hands down, yeah.
This game was not optimized for PS4 Pro. This is not
It was. Apparently they spent time working on that.
Which, by the way, remember the company line back when I said the reason they delayed it is so they can do this PS4 Pro patch?
Yeah.
Remember what they originally said? We're delaying it so we can put the day one patch on the disc.
God. Yeah.
Seven and gigs the day one patch was.
Yeah. Nine gigs.
So... they lied to us.
Yeah, of course.
Well, they put that day one patch.
Yeah, no, this was.
And then they had to make another day one patch.
But yeah. you were playing it on Saturday before the. How was it before the patch?
Oh, there was no that 7 gig patch was there Saturday.
I went over to.
I thought they don't even release the patch until the actual release.
No, I went over to Nolan's and I installed the patch.
Brett installed the patch
at the midnight launch.
I was wondering how you did that.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, okay, guys, we're gonna talk about this for a couple weeks, I'm sure. So. We're about an hour in. We need to take a break. But when we come back,
see my chocobo's name.
What is it? Oh God, I forgot. No, wait, what's the name? I didn't see it.
Dick butt.
Of course, it's Dick butt.
Such a majestic creature.
Did y'all see my tweet earlier? Because when I played the Final Fantasy 15 demo, I had named my carbuncle Red Rocket.
Oh, nice thing.
And I'd forgot about it. So when I booted up the game, it was like, good news, Red Rocket's gonna join you on your journey. And I was like, I forgot about that. Okay.
But so far, I'm 12 hours in and I have not seen him since the tutorial.
Yeah, he gave me a little tutorial.
Also, that cool sword that you get if you get the day one edition.
Oh, fuck, I forgot.
Or whatever.
I forgot to even install
it. It becomes, pointless very quickly.
I don't think I've ever played a game where they've given you an item for pre-ordering that doesn't become almost immediately useless.
Unless it's cosmetic shit. Yeah. No, that's what they should. They should give you something cosmetic.
Like
an exclusive outfit or
something. Every Dragon Age game has had something like that, and the items are always pieces of shit.
Yep. It's overpowered for the first 3 hours. Yeah, yeah.
Before we take a break, one thing I wanted to say, and I like Nolan, has some problems, still really enjoying it. I'm going to keep playing it for a long time.
Yeah.
But one thing for me about Final Fantasy is that I had the same problem with 13, and since this was originally a 13 game, it suffers from kind of the same problem. One of my biggest problems with 13 is that the world feels a little too familiar. It feels a little too close to
Real
reality.
It's not fantastical enough.
What they're going for here. Coleman Tents.
I know, but my favorite Final Fantasies, my favorite Final Fantasy ever is 9.
Oh yeah, that's pretty fantastic.
And I'm still because they modified a game that was previously part of the 13 universe.
Everything's humanoid. Yeah. You know, you're not having companions that are weird creatures.
The people are wearing jeans and sandals.
Everyone has a southern accent.
Driving a fucking Audi.
Everyone has a southern accent.
I kind of like when it is more fantasy than what it is. Yeah.
Nine was that way because it was a throwback.
But
to
like
the
nine
other Final
and
Fantasies
like tactics like and like all that shit.
Pet peeve about the chocobos is you have to rent them. Yeah. It's 50 gil a day, so it's not really that big of a deal. It's just frustrating that that's even there.
Yeah.
Like why? Like why? Like I don't
know. Like you're the fucking prince.
There's a part
why don't you
where
have a
maybe
chocobo?
You don't have access to your car for a little bit, and when that chocobo runs out, and you're just standing in the middle of the world, you're just like.
You can call your car, do you?
No.
He's saying there's a part of the game.
There's a part where you don't have access to your car. When that chocobo rental runs out, you're just standing in the middle of this giant world going, are you fucking kidding me? Are you fucking kidding me?
Anytime I'm near a chocobo rental, I just always
pay the
extra money.
I'm picturing Brad saying, are you fucking kidding me? And the camera pulls back 20 feet. Are you fucking kidding me? And then it pulls back another 100 yards. You're just standing in the middle of a big empty field. Are you fucking kidding me?
Yep.
That's awesome. All right, we really need to take a break.
Yeah.
We'll talk more about Final Fantasy 15 probably on next week's episode. But when we come back, we'll talk about Watch Dogs 2, Pokemon Moon, Persona 4, maybe a little Dishonored 2. So don't go anywhere. We'll be back in just a minute. We're going to take a break. All right, welcome back to the show. I know we talked a lot about Final Fantasy 15 during the first segment, but we still have more new games to talk about. It's like I said at the beginning of the show, it's been 2 weeks since we recorded a show, and in that time span, not only has Final Fantasy 15 come out, but Watch Dogs 2 came out, Crispy's been playing it. I played about 2 hours of it, so I can kind of chime in a little bit.
No,
but
don't.
But tell us what you're...
Don't chime in.
Oh, fine.
You're fucking, fucking noob. I'm a base guy.
Shut my noob mouth.
Like an hour, and I watched the first season of Mr. Robot.
Oh, I still haven't seen that show.
An hour of what? What's wrong with you?
Watch Dogs 2.
Dude, stop watching DC shit.
I'm not. You know what I've been watching? I'm like Bob's Burgers 1,000 times.
That's a pretty good show.
So stop watching Bob's Burgers.
I haven't watched 1,001 times. Oh, and Last Man on Earth came back, which I enjoy greatly. But we're talking about Watch Dogs.
We are talking about Watch Dogs. Watch Dogs 2.
Yeah, this is footage I recorded. This is like 28 minutes of Watch Dogs.
Great.
Like, you should just watch it. Like, I don't even have to explain. This,
you should
this
just
kind of just goes through it.
Dogs.
All. Just Watch Dogs.
Watch Dogs 2.
They should call it Watch Dogs again. Like, they should call it, like, Watch Dogs Do-Over.
That was the best.
Just got the car
You
crashed.
Start the footage, and then you just burn out around a corner and just boom.
Smash the car. That's, smash the that's car.
I will tell you this. The short time I played Watch Dogs 2,
it's a lot
that,
of
that right there sums up how I feel about the driving in it. It is
some
hard.
Some of the cars are like some of the sports cars are super responsive, and then you get like a muscle car like this that's really good at going fast in a straight line but doesn't turn so well. And I was like, okay, fuck that car. And I get into it. Like a sportier car here, and then everything's fine. But my opinions of the game after probably playing, I don't know, somewhere around the 10 to 12 hour mark.
Okay.
Is that this is just kind of this is Assassin's Creed 2, kind of all over again.
To Watch Dogs.
This
was a pretty big improvement.
This maybe isn't quite as much of a foundational overhaul as Assassin's Creed 2 was over Assassin's Creed 1, but it definitely was kind of like an across the board, like kind of re-sweeping and like kind of a restructuring of a lot of different elements and adding a few nice little touches here and there.
Assassin's Creed 2, does it add like the much needed personality?
Right. Yes, that is the biggest improvement. Probably
this is a very exuberant game.
Yeah, the story still has the story is a much just more palatable to me than Watch Dogs 1. Watch Dogs 1, it seemed like they were so concerned about trying to create the mechanics of like this hacker controlling a city that they didn't spend a lot of time considering like why he would be doing that. Like they didn't add any like real pathos to the character. You didn't really feel sorry for him at all because he was kind of just like an angry dick. And it kind of dragged the whole experience down because you don't have anything kind of pulling you through the story. This game kind of takes a different approach to the whole like vigilante hacker angle instead of making him just like a Batman with phones who kills people, which is kind of how I view.
Yeah, he was like.
It's kind of how I view Aiden Pierce.
Yeah,
like
he was super dark.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Didn't have much of a like a likable personality to.
Yeah, in this one they kind of like channel more of like the hacktivist quote unquote.
Yeah.
Like their
archetype, which
society.
Yeah, which yeah. seems to be a little bit more topical. If you will, you know?
You know, honestly, you keep bringing up Mr. Robot, but I have a feeling that had a really big impact.
Oh, for sure.
Oh, no, it definitely did. For it definitely sure. did.
Like, the group, your character Marcus is a new initiate in a group called DedSec, and they basically just fight corporate corruption and breach of privacy, basically.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They work out of an old arcade.
Yeah.
Well, the first hideout is in the back room of a like
video
a board game store. A board game store.
Board game store.
Yeah. And then you get more hideouts.
Can you just play board games?
No, you can't. I wish you could.
2 out of 10.
I really wish you could. Yeah. That's
can
a
you
huge
listen to
miss.
Diane Young?
You can't.
2 out of 10.
I mean, you could put your iPod on and play with it playing on your own, but no. It's
you can blow up manholes with hacking.
If you played Watch Dogs 1,
I can blow up
a lot of the same mechanics hacking. like hacking traffic lights, hacking cars, hacking like the sewer mains to blow up when you drive over them, like all that stuff is still here.
Yeah.
And that's still like a big bulk of the action.
The thing is, Brad says that almost like as a joke because it's ridiculous.
Yes.
Right? And it is ridiculous, but since when has that bothered you? Like, it's in the service of fun. This like, is one thing Watch Dogs has always done from the beginning is, like, their mechanics don't make any sense. Like, that's not how the world
works. In the first game, that felt, like, really glaring. I remember having a huge problem with the whole conceit of CTOS and how everything's plugged into it and how much it's just, like... Like, it doesn't make any sense, but that's only because I wasn't having any fucking fun with the story, you know? Yeah. When you're not thinking about, like, oh, what's this character going through? What are they going to do next? How are things going to turn out for Aiden? When you're not concerned about that, because you don't give a shit about the story or the main character, then you start looking at the whole construction of the game, and it all just seems to kind of pale. It's amazing what a semi-likable protagonist does to make you more forgiving to that shit. It is amazing how when the game is willing to have fun with you, you're willing to have fun with it, yeah. You know?
That's a good way of putting
it. But they talk about the manholes.
They don't.
Okay.
Like, they don't. They don't spend
it. But, like, but I mean, right down to the point.
Or lifting a dude, bridge, that kind of makes sense. It doesn't make sense, but
right,
it kind of.
You're not, right.
You're
but
not
like,
hacking
right down,
manholes. You're hacking the gas lines that are exploding that are causing the fucking.
That makes more sense than hacking the grenades that the guards are carrying, which is something you can do. You can hack grenades to go off on guards. So, like, that makes. The only reason why you would network a grenade to a citywide operating system is that so a hacker could cause it to go off. Yeah, like, there's no other reason. It's not like Command Central is ever going to need that function.
They did it for law enforcement.
Like, check
purposes,
the Wi-Fi
Christy.
On your grenades. They might not go off if you're in a bad signal area. Like what? That's retard. I'm sorry. I can't. That's R-word.org.
I thought we agreed. I thought we agreed before the show this was becoming the
C-word. You're right.
C-word.
It was C-word.
Now we're going to use C-word. It's a little...
But anyway, I'm sorry. It's stupid. It's poor design. How about that?
Yes.
Okay, I'm so sorry. I feel like I'm done talking.
No, there's nothing. You're doing great. You're doing great. This is one little.
But
how's the dude with the mask?
Okay, you know what? I went into this thinking I was gonna fucking hate that guy. Rich. Like, oh, he's so like they're just trying too fucking hard. But like. I don't know, when you're in there and, like, the whole crew's, like, palling around working together, you're like, I'm invested enough that I want them to succeed.
There's a parallel between this and Final Fantasy 15, where you thought everyone was going to be real douchey, but, you know, sometimes the
douche
grows
once
on you.
Once you've, like, cracked enough jokes about it, and once that, like, fades away and you just get into, like, these are characters who have wants and needs and are working together to achieve that, like... It works. It flies.
I remember, in the 2 hours that I played, I got to the first
I think Wrench is kind of funny,
actually. And I met all the team members, right? And I remember thinking, like as kind of ridiculous and outlandish as this all is and these characters are, like, I like these characters, I think. Like, just first impression-wise, I was like, I could play a game.
I hacked a grenade on that
guy. That's amazing.
Why did that cop have a grenade?
I don't know.
That's the
but
better
like,
question.
Let me ask you, though. Is
that's
it,
standard
are these
issue.
Characters likable because it's like, yeah, I'm like these guys.
No. I mean, they have more of a sense of... They're
smart. They seem smart.
I almost
want to
say that.
I don't.
I mean, like the arc of their story through playing the story quests makes a bit more sense than Aiden Pierce's did, and it's amazing when a character has like a semi-cogent arc. How much more you can empathize with them?
I like how
you're
just sitting in the middle of the road controlling a drone.
Oh yeah, you do that all the time. Like every time you throw out one of your gadgets or something, he just sits down on his laptop wherever you are and
like
starts.
So
like if you're in the middle of the road, like people will just like drive around you. Like,
I almost want to say that like, what works for it is that Watch Dogs 2 actually kind of feels like. A fantasy world almost instead like Watch Dogs 1
I mean kind
going
of but
more...
but what I was saying as far as like the verisimilitude of the characters, there's more opportunity for these characters to like you do missions that are just like them hanging out like fucking around like Wrench and one of the missions comes up to you and is like, dude, they're shooting a sequel to like this movie, like we gotta go fucking check that out. So like you guys go to the movie set and the movie is kind of like a Knight Rider send off, so it's about a computerized car and you end up like hacking into the studio and like stealing the car and like joyriding it around and shit. So like there's a lot more detail, like there's less the mission or the missions in the game aren't all completely structured around going after the main enemy, which is Bloom, like the big corporate bad guys of the game. Like there's a lot of time given to just like developing these characters and their relationships to each other. I just did a story mission not that long ago where like they all go to a Burning Man type festival. Mm-hmm. Like they something happened in the course of their crusade. They got kind of fucked over by another group, and they're all thinking that they're going to walk away and just stop doing the whole DedSec thing. So they all go out to like fucking Burning Man and like do drugs and shit like that. That's their big rally moment to like come back. It seems like,
in addition to maybe being inspired by Mr. Robot, like it feels like some of their missions, they've looked at like how Rockstar does some of their missions, how there are some more outlandish, silly. Yeah. Like that, like the one mission I did that, like even in the short time I played it, I did a mission where you have to go to this like rapper's house and like hack his phone to steal.
So you can make a soundboard. Yeah.
You can make a soundboard, and then you can use it to blackmail.
Well, that mission is a straight up. That mission was the fucking Martin Shkreli or whatever the farm. Yeah, the farm exec who raised those prices on the what was it?
The HIV
medication.
Isn't the Wu-Tang Clan?
Because that was the same guy. Yeah, that was the same guy. He bought that Legend of the Wu or whatever, the Wu-Tang Clan album that he's the only one in the world that has a copy of it.
Yeah.
That's what this mission is you intercepting the sale of that album so that you can like fuck him over and take all of his money and then like release the music to everyone in the world.
So you can hack grenades and you can hack bank accounts. Can you hack someone's pacemaker and just kill them?
No, I wish.
Can you hack
they're saving that for Watch Dogs 3.
I mean, at this point, why not? Just fucking you go and there's a guard.
That would make
a
lot more sense than a lot of
you just
shit.
Fucking just...
You just turn him off.
Yeah.
You just
can you hack someone's clothes
you can,
off?
You can... No.
Can you hack a woman onto the ground and look at her vagina through her crotchless panties?
Not anymore, apparently. That was a thing before they patched it when it first came out. Yeah. Some dude was playing the game. He had an early copy and he like ran over a prostitute.
No, there was one particular.
Okay, I knew there was a vagina in the game.
Yeah, that's what
I didn't
was,
know
yeah.
the context. Is that really the context?
Crotchless panties.
Well, you didn't hack her to see it.
Okay,
you had to kill her to see it.
Oh, natural. Just
hack it on up.
Furry.
Oh my god.
I really, really like this drone, by the way.
I can tell you.
As far as like additions to the game, like, because so much of the game is about going into these restricted areas where it's really difficult to stealth around and not get caught. And if you get caught, like, the problem with the way stealth in this game works is if any enemy sees you, even if you like are about to take them out, there are certain things you're doing where if they make eye contact with you, they automatically send like I'm sending a description. Like even if like it's them looking at you and you shooting them with a stun gun, your description already goes out to all the other ones. They all know exactly where you are, and then they start sending in reinforcements after you.
Like Assassin's Creed and stuff like Red Dead is the only fucking game in the world that if you kill all the witnesses, no one knows. And I fucking hate that more games haven't done that.
That's not even true. Most games are like that nowadays.
Not necessarily.
A lot more stealth games do give you an opportunity to kind of like cancel out witnesses before they call for backup. This game is the absolute worst about that. But what I've figured out, and maybe I'm just stupid for not realizing this earlier, but is that you really shouldn't ever go into those areas unless you absolutely have to. You need to be relying on cameras, your jumper, which is the little RC car, and your quadcopter. Like, that's how you're supposed to do a lot of this shit. And if you do that, it's actually super easy. It gets way, way easier. My biggest thing was I didn't want to use guns. I'm playing this game with just the stun gun because I don't think it makes any...
What about your yo-yo?
I don't think it makes any... Well, it's not a yo-yo, but I do use that. But that's not even like a weapon per se. That's like a contextual thing. It's like Ezio's hidden blade. It's like you can only use it in certain situations where it gives you a prompt to do melee and then you do melee. Otherwise, if you hit the melee button, he just like pulls it out and swings it around and puts it back.
Just like a penis.
But, yeah. Sorry, just like his dick.
I have one important question.
But, hang on, I'm still talking.
I'm sorry.
But, like...
Why does the music suck?
The game, it doesn't. The game, fuck you guys.
No,
never mind.
It actually doesn't.
Never mind, I don't remember the point I was making. What? Go ahead.
Really?
No.
I don't remember. You guys knocked it out of my head.
That was Brad.
I think you were talking about drones and I'm making it easier for you.
I was talking about the fact that like the game's set up like a stealth game, but they don't want you to use stealth tactics. They want you to use hacking. Because the easiest way I found to clear out any of those areas is to hack into cameras or send the drone in, hack every trap in the environment to try to whittle down the guards. And then once they're either all dead, incapacitated, or in a state of disarray, run in, do your objective really quick, and run the fuck out.
It's kind of
it's not a Hitman game. It's not a Dishonored. It's not.
It's like a Batman.
It's not even like Batman. Like, you are severely penalized for engaging anybody in combat. Mm-hmm. Like if it comes down to you and really somebody else in a firefight, like, it's bad.
They just really lean into the hacking
hardcore. Yeah, like, you can play with, like, guns. If you want to run in and shoot everybody, that makes... That's a way to do it. But I feel like guns are only in this game to make it more like other games people
like
have played.
Deus Ex?
Like the game doesn't make any fucking... Like Marcus and these DedSec guys running around with guns murdering hundreds of people makes no sense at all to me whatsoever. That's why I've only been using the stun gun, because that's the only thing I could even comprehend him doing, like using, you know?
Like Deus Ex.
Yeah, like Deus Ex.
Yeah, no, you're right, That makes sense. My question I was going to ask you, my favorite thing to do in Watch Dogs 1 was cause blackouts. You can still do that in this game?
Yeah, eventually.
Loved Call of Duty.
So my favorite thing in Watch Dogs 1 was invading people's games. Have you done any co-op or anything like that yet?
I've had, now that they've fixed. Now that they fixed like all the online shit, I've had a few people invade my game. Mm-hmm. And like, that's really fucking annoying when you're just trying to do story missions and then somebody pops up and is trying to invade.
That's no one.
Look at
the smile on his face.
It's really low stakes, and I kind of just ignore it.
You don't exactly like lose a lot for like failing. Those.
In this one, what it is they steal followers. So throughout the whole game, every mission you do, every like challenge you complete, everything you do gives you followers. And you by the end of the game, you have to hit a certain number of followers to be able to take on
like social media, right?
Well, they have this in the story of the game. They have an app, a DedSec app, and when they say followers, what they mean is getting people to download the app and run it on their phones or their computers or whatever, because that gives DedSec access to all of their processing.
The big Batman computer,
right. Like at the end they're trying to build a giant network of computers to basically be like a data farm for them to run processing for whatever their hacks are, you know, for whatever they're doing.
They try and work in a lot more like technical mumbo jumbo, even though, you know, it's all for the most. I mean, a lot of it's fictional,
right? Oh, yeah.
But they would have you believe that a lot of this is more possible than it actually is.
Yeah,
because they lean into the technical jargon pretty hard, at least based on what I saw at the beginning.
Bam.
I mean, it's in the whole like fiction of it revolves around the fact that everything is integrated with CTOS.
Yeah.
And those cops don't even know you just did that.
Yeah. I was like, I don't know what was happening here. Those gang members were in an alley and they killed an NPC. And I heard the gunshots. I heard somebody call for 911. I backed up to see what was going on. When I saw it was one of those little gang areas, I started hacking it. I hacked into it and I started like fucking around with them while the cops were coming to arrest them. And I ended up just killing all three of them before the cops got there. And then the cops were just like, okay, and they walked away while I was just like, all right.
Some dead bodies, nothing for us.
I'm just gonna...
We'll just leave those there.
Like, sir, you saw everything that happened. Yeah, I'm just gonna go. But yeah, I didn't think Watch Dogs 1 was necessarily a bad game. It just was...
It wasn't the worst.
It was really tiresome. Like, it just didn't hold my attention.
The story was the worst part about the game.
Yeah,
is the problem.
It was.
And the gameplay is such... The gameplay isn't, like, phenomenal. It's such that, like, without that kind of narrative hook to drag you through it, you know, you're probably just going to stop playing before you get to the end, which is exactly what I did.
Yeah, me too.
But this one I'm enjoying a lot more. And I think it's a good step up. Yeah.
I'll be honest. I'm playing it. I'm trying to prioritize what I want to play before the end of the year. And this is
I would recommend because they don't.
It's too much.
When you start playing it,
It might not make the cut before the end of the year.
When you start playing it, I would recommend you just save up your money. Don't spend anything until you get the quadcopter. The quadcopter,
like the chocobo.
Don't do anything until you have a chocobo. Well, don't do anything until you have a quadcopter.
It's because they don't limit you at all in the story, really. As far as like when you can unlock that device,
yeah.
It's like $50,000. As soon as you get $50,000, you can get a quadcopter, and it really changes this game from being you jumping from like static camera positions to like you actually moving around in environment.
How much those things cost?
How much?
No, not in real life. I mean, some of them do, but
how much? They're pretty.
Are we talking about drones?
In the game, it's like $50,000.
Well, that's not that much.
Oh yeah.
But this, I'm there was something else I was gonna say.
And say you like it.
Shut up.
No, I mean that's. I'm glad you're liking it. I want to.
No, I do like it. Oh God.
But you're making him lose.
No,
his
there was an actual point I was gonna make.
Well, hey, you know what? There was some stuff that I wanted to make about Final Fantasy 15. I forgot, like about the homoeroticism and how exciting that was. But you know, there's next week.
Mm-hmm.
You'll finish it. We'll play more Final Fantasy 15.
I'm on the cusp of it. God damn it.
If it comes back to you, just interrupt whoever the hell is talking.
Oh, yeah, I was just going to say, okay. It wasn't even anything. It was like, I really like the story. I like the game. I think the story, the story just starts, too. I love it. They just drop you in.
Like, literally.
Like, it's not, like, about, like, oh, this up-and-coming hacker retro catching the eye of Dedzek and then, like, joining their ranks and everything. Like, the beginning of the game is you doing your final initiation to join Dedsec. They don't bog you down with backstory or anything. They're just like, all right, break into CTOS and wipe your profile. You do that, you're in Dedsec. And then you do that.
And then they go to
a big party and they're like, yeah, you're one of us, bro. It's a cold open. They don't really bog you down with a lot of story, which I think is something that definitely could have tanked this whole experience. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's fucking
like
great.
They keep doing with Spider-Man movies. I see one more origin,
we're going to.
Yeah. No, they better not do it.
Homecoming is not an origin.
No, there's no origin story in Homecoming.
That's why it's called Homecoming.
Which is great. All right, so I have a little game I want to talk about for just a smidge, because I've only played it a smidge, not very much. I picked up Pokemon Moon.
Ooh.
For what reason, I don't know.
I picked it up
a day before Final Fantasy 15 came out. I don't know what the fuck I was thinking.
Because it's shiny and it's new and it's got good reviews.
It does. It does have good reviews. And I do like Pokemon. Or I like what it stands... I don't know. I'm playing Pokemon again, guys. Mm-hmm. I picked it up in the 3D. I picked up Moon. I wanted to see what the hubbub was about. Because it's been getting really good reviews across the board. I mean, most Pokemon games get pretty good reviews, but a lot of people have been talking about this being, you know, a pretty dramatic step forward for the series. I wanted to see what that was all about.
Huh.
And I think what surprised me, or not necessarily surprised me, because, you know, we always talk about Pokemon not really evolving over the course of the years. It's been around since...
No, they evolve.
They evolve.
Yeah. Sometimes you have to use a stone.
Shut the fuck up.
Or you have to trade them.
You know what I mean.
How does this one evolve, Nick?
They haven't... Okay, so...
Of course you picked that fucking thing. I knew
you
would.
Owls. What the fuck's wrong with
you
picking
you? You like owls?
I like owls.
Who?
Nick, you're not bookish enough to like owls.
I'm not bookish. What the fuck does that even mean?
You're not even
I picked
based.
The owl because I like... Owls are like one of my favorite animals. Coo.
Jesus, like everyone's favorite animals.
Yeah, because they're fucking coo. So I picked the owl.
Fucking get an original bone
in
your
body.
I'd
pick
Papalia.
Wait, what is the... what's
Papalia
the water starter?
Sexy.
That one.
Is it a...
It's like a seal.
A seal.
I heard everyone's like super sad because they thought the cat was so cool, but then he turns into like a muscly wrestling cat, and everyone's like, "Whoa, no!
Don't evolve, undo." Yeah. So, I picked this up. I've only played about 2 hours of it, to be totally honest. And I wasn't expecting a lot as far as changes go, but I'll be honest, like. Most of the changes that I'm seeing here are like presentation on the way are present like the game
just how they display the game.
Like
if you're starting a battle with a Caterpie with a third of its health, like
that. Well, I do that predominantly, and this is something I've done since the beginning when I started playing Pokemon Red, like way back in the fucking day. It's just, you know, you always load in the weak Pokemon first, then you switch it, that way the first one gets experience and you
still
can
have to
level them up.
Oh, you're scumming.
This is one thing I've always said of Pokemon.
They've always had that device, and they start giving it to you a lot earlier.
Eventually, they do.
Jeez, you're sucking.
In the newer games,
I know. That, like, this is what I'm talking about. This is
terrible footage.
Fuck you, Brett. Fuck you.
You ruined this podcast.
The experience share is what you're thinking of, Crispy.
XP share.
They often call it the EXP share.
Point is, a lot of the changes to like gameplay and systems, you know, are pretty fucking minuscule here. The first thing that pops into my head is like one of the biggest things is they started giving you experience for battles you fight when you catch Pokemon.
Mm-hmm.
So before you would catch Pokemon and when you caught it, you didn't technically finish the fight, so you didn't get any experience. But you actually earn experience for every fight that you go into, which is nice. I like that. It kind of helps move things along a little bit quicker. They've redesigned the Pokédex. They've redesigned like the interface and the bottom screen. It all looks very nice. The actual character ring in the... I haven't played a Pokemon game in a very long time. So, like, this is quite a jump for me going... I can't remember how much... How
What's the last Pokemon game you finished?
Finished? I think it was Emerald.
Maybe. Didn't you finish one of the Moons or Pearls or something like that?
I played, like, a good portion of Pearl.
Mm-hmm.
See, like, one of the things I've always struggled with Pokemon is I almost always pick up Pokemon because of nostalgia.
Yeah.
Like, one thing I've always loved about it, I like its presentation. I like its music a lot. I like just the vibe of, like, walking around, like, that... I like the world, walking around talking to people, fighting trainers and whatnot. It's always been very nostalgic to me, but, like... I've always struggled with this, like, well, I'm not going to play all the Pokemons. I'm not a crazy person. I'm never going to catch them all
because
I'm not a crazy person.
Just do it.
But shut the fuck up, Brad. No, I'm not going to catch them all. And the point, thing I've always asked myself is, if I'm not going to catch them all, is there a point to me playing this?
Yeah, to get a fucking, what's his name? Haunter? Or what's his, Gengar?
Gengar?
Yeah, he's the dopest Pokemon. Just get one of those and you're good.
But Nick doesn't have any friends, so we'd have to trade to get him.
Gengar?
Because Hunter only evolves to a Gengar when you trade him.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Does that still hold true in the new ones?
Probably.
I don't fucking know. It's weird. It's weird also seeing how some Pokemon, like classic Pokemon, have changed and others haven't. Like, I saw someone throw out a Rattata the other day. I was like, what the fuck? That looks like...
Was it like black or something like that?
No, it was like standing on two. It was standing on its back legs, and it
you do know that this game has like different like
regional
regional Pokemon that even though they're the same, like there's a fucking surfing Raichu.
Oh,
yeah, like they've changed some because in
the
this region
executes or whatever
are like 40 feet tall, like their neck.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Executor.
Did you get a shiny Ponyta?
No, I've only got
Red
I've
Gyarados?
Only caught six Pokemon so far, guys.
So you have a Mewtwo.
Yes, that's one of the six that I've caught.
Oh, cool.
Totally.
But it's still, like,
missing
Pokemon-y, right?
It's still fucking Pokemon-y. I mean, it takes place in, like, the atmosphere is a little bit different. They've replaced some of the key, like the professor has been replaced by this guy, Hala.
Hala at your boy.
I mean, it takes place in, essentially Hawaii. So, you know, it's kind of been, like, a little bit of a palette swap as far as the environments go. Everyone seems a lot nicer. I don't know.
Your rival's not really a rival.
Like your rival
Islanders
is,
are just
your
happy
rival.
And...
Your rival, quote unquote, is like you know how you've all like past Pokemon games. Like your rival's always been like someone that you're kind of like trading insults with and like kind of aggressive towards the entire game.
You're like banging his mom and stuff.
Exactly.
In this game, you're like cousins, and you're like. Oh, you're so, like you're more like role models to each other. It's weird.
Maybe
it's
by
like
the end of the game, you hate each other.
It's a very, it's a very happy game.
Is Bulbasaur in this?
I don't fucking know, dude. I don't even know how many Pokemon are in this game. I don't know if it's like one thing that's always confused me is like, well, are all the Pokemon available to catch, or do you have to trade them between different versions? I don't fucking know. I have a feeling.
I mean,
how many
Wonder,
Pokemon
with,
are there now? Like
with
800?
Wonder Trade, you can trade from there because they have like an online. You know, they have like an online storage now.
Yeah.
That you can, like yeah. So
I mean, the
can,
thing is, like, I'm never going to get to that level that I was at with like Pokemon Blue.
Oh yeah.
Where I was like, trading with the fucking wire with friends and like
you know why,
cloning
Nick?
Them because
you're not in middle school
do
anymore.
You remember that shit
yeah.
Cloning unplugging the fucking wire in the middle of the transfer
you
like
to keep it yeah
like I'm not there's never
playing
gonna,
god really.
There's never gonna be that meta game anymore for me it's like that nostalgia
the
part
exploits.
Is never going to be there
they're all gone
but
who's Team Rocket in this game
I haven't even gotten there yet I don't know like one thing I just know is like you know it, I felt like it'd be kind of nice to go back and play a Pokemon game even if I know that means I'm not going to catch all the Pokemon I'm not going to see all the Pokemon I just want to catch some Pokemon and fight the
make
Elite
them
Four
fight
and
each other
just be done with it
this is fucking
what it
is
looks it
elite
looks really
four?
It looks really good though like as far as for a Pokemon game, like the anime, they've stepped up their animations quite a bit. But hey, that's really all I can say about it so far.
Take care of my little Nick.
That's my mom. You know, hanging out, watch me fight Pokemon trainers. That's my cousin. He's nice. He's my rival.
Why are you so pasty? Aren't you an island?
Because he's not from Hawaii.
No, like the game opens with you moving it's to every the island game. Of Aloha.
You move to this place.
You move there because your mom loves
Nick
Pokemon.
Finally had to leave the basement and move to Hawaii, and now he has to fight animals.
So yeah,
cool.
Against each That's other. Pokemon Moon. That's all I can really say about it. I'm gonna keep.
You're gonna
playing.
Finish this?
That's yet to be seen, but I'm gonna keep
Just
playing.
Just say no.
Well, I don't. I want
it's
to.
Okay.
I want to.
I didn't finish Fire Emblem. Who has time for handhelds?
Dude, I still haven't finished Majora's Mask on the 3DS.
Oh, well, whatever.
And I'm on the last dungeon.
I finished that.
I might as well have finished it. I've taken that game far enough to finish it.
You've played Majora's Mask before.
I know.
That's why you're not.
But
as
the
motivated.
Best once again, the best version of that particular Zelda game is now on the 3DS.
Yeah, it's true.
And I finished Ocarina of Time on the 3DS because that was amazing. Nolan,
what up?
You wanted to say some things about Persona 4, didn't you?
Yes.
How's that going?
It's good. I am quite a ways into the game, close to 40 hours. So it's a big chunk. I've surpassed Nick probably by now.
Yep. For sure. I only played like most like 25 hours.
Oh, then yeah, I'm way past you. I'm about to finish the Yuki challenge.
I never finished the Yuki challenge.
I got a trophy for getting her to level 9 out of 10. So next time, it'll be 10 out of 10. And I guess we'll bang.
Home run.
Yeah.
I don't think you're going to have sex.
Okay, we're not having this conversation
I don't remember
again.
Having sex, and I definitely got to 10.
We're never having that conversation again.
I think we hung out together in a room and talked about martial arts or something.
That was probably Chie, not Yuki.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I had Chie. Yeah. No, I got Yuki to 9, and I told her no.
Oh, shit.
Chie
what?
Is such a prude.
Yeah, she is. Oh, my God. Anyway, I've actually been getting into the story of this game a lot more than I did 3, I guess.
Yeah.
I like some of the characters. I like there's a lot more variety than there was in 3. I like, you know, the different jobs you can do. I like there's just so much more you can do in a day. Even though you're limited to like actual, you know,
Man,
one daytime activity and one
would
evening.
Would not have liked 3 then cuz I feel limited in 4.
Because in 3 or, you know, in this you have a daytime activity and evening activity, but you can also do kind of like sub things. Like you can go and do this, and you can like kind of talk.
Work
to this.
At the bar.
You can a lot of times those take up time, but there are other smaller things you can do, like planting and harvesting vegetables, and you know catching bugs to trade in, and like you know fishing, you know whatever. There are other little things you can do that don't. You know, they don't take up as much. This is my first time fishing, actually.
I don't think I've ever fished.
I don't know what the point of it is.
Yeah.
You need diligence to fish, I guess. I don't know. Mm-hmm. So I was like, check out fishing. Dude, fucking, oh my God. That's one of the things I'm so glad they brought back in this game was the Tanaka's, like, shopping channel. It's because the music is so fucking good and just it's so over the top. And I love at the end of like the third game, because you didn't finish it, Brad. Like Tanaka gets like in big trouble for like stealing like money and stuff, and he's like, my company is so great, and then he like leaves or something like that. But now he's back in this, just selling shit again.
Interlacing is terrible here.
Huh?
Is that, this is the PSTV.
PSTV. I mean, it's all. I mean, it might just because it's. I don't know.
Man,
how it was captured or what?
Nolan couldn't even use my Vita.
Oh yeah, that was the bullshit thing. Was I almost
traded in my Vita to get Pokemon.
I tried to use Nick's Vita to play this, but the problem is
I'm never gonna fucking play that thing again.
I didn't. A memory card is locked to an account, which is locked to a Vita. So to if I were to play my game on Nick's Vita, I'd actually have to format his Vita and clear it. And then log in and register the Vita as mine. But before I do that, Nick would have to sign into his PlayStation account and like deauthorize his that Vita.
And that's far too much trouble.
And that's just like and Nick was willing to do it, but I was telling him like, Nick, don't even bother. Like
You're
that
supposed
is way
to play
too
Symphony
much.
Of the Night on your Vita.
That is
You're
way too much.
You're gonna trade
work.
It in for Pokemon. A Pokemon game that you'll probably play 15 hours. Of and never touch again.
Oh my God! You'll have to play Symphony of the Night.
I
Symphony of the
myself.
Night for any of the other dozen things it's available for.
Well, I mean, the
emulated on.
I probably have like six systems in my home, right, which I could use to play some of the night. But yes, I see your point, and I did not trade it in because I realized. I mean, how dumb that idea was.
You could still play cool port. You play Darkest Dungeon on your fucking Vita. You know?
Honestly, it was the fact that I can go back and play.
Sounds like a couple of Vita owners justifying owning a Vita to each other.
No, it's a really slick.
You fucking rubes. And you fucking rubes.
It's easy to mod too.
So one of the things I will say about this game is it seems like there was a lot. Quests are very different in this than they were in 3. In 3, there were quests, but you got them by going to like the Velvet Room and talking to Elizabeth. And she would just kind of give you random quests. Like, oh, go do this, and go do this, and blah, blah, blah. Whereas in this game, there are some quests that are kind of like that. There's the social link, the Hermit, where people will go to the shrine and they submit like kind of like, they're called Emmas. And essentially, it's like a prayer.
Yeah.
To like a god, and in this case, the fox like gets it and he gives it to you, and the fox is like, "Oh, complete this quest, then I'll be happy." He doesn't talk though; he just like yips because he's a fox. And this is one of the ones where this guy said that this guy's scared of cats, but he's getting married to a lady who loves cats, and he wants you to help this guy get over his fear of cats.
Immersion therapy.
Is that no? Pretty much. No,
it's immersive. Like,
what I end up doing is I find a cat and then I bring the guy to it, and that's what happens right here. And like I bring the guy to the cat, and the cat starts like the guy starts like freaking out because it's a cat.
Of course.
Yeah. I was kind of confused by this. I was like, wait, bring him here? And I was like, oh, I guess it means the guy. I thought I was gonna like bring the cat to the guy. I don't know. Yeah, he starts freaking out because like the cat starts licking him, and he's like, "Oh my god, it's eating me!"
And then I mean, when cats lick you, it kind of feels like they're eating you because they're kind of like sandpaper.
They are. But yeah, so I like the quests in this game because they feel a lot more personal than in 3. In 3, they were just very disjointed and very random, and it's like Elizabeth was like, "Oh, get me 3 of this." They kind of almost fetch questy.
Yeah.
Go into the. In that case, Tartarus, which was the equivalent of going to the TV world here.
Yeah.
In 3, it was Tartarus. And it would be like, go in there and get me 10 of this item.
Yeah.
And that's pretty much it. But whereas in this, there is some of that. You'll run into somebody and they'll be like, oh, I wish I had this. And it's an item you can find in the TV world.
Yeah.
But it doesn't feel like a fetch quest as much as it did in the previous game. Like, it feels like, oh, I'm just going because I'm helping out this person.
Yeah.
And I like that just because you find them randomly in the world. They have these little, like, symbol over their head so you know they have a quest for you. And you can go and do it. This is me spending time with Yukiko. At the end of this, I actually end up getting a trophy for... I guess not... becoming her lover, I guess.
Fucking her?
Well, not yet.
We're not having this conversation again.
That's rank 10. Oh. But yeah, I'm still astonished as to how much voice acting is in this game. Like, how many, like, just cutscenes and stuff.
I told you, it's crazy.
There's so much. Like, some of the interactions aren't, but this entire scene is fully voice acted.
That's also one thing we didn't bring up in Final Fantasy XV. There's a lot of voice acting in that, too.
Yeah, there is.
Maybe not as much as this, but...
Yeah. But in this, they don't all have southern accents.
Yeah.
So it's more believable.
I figured that was just, like, a regional thing. Did that not change? And you?
No.
That's weird.
Everyone's southern. But yeah, no, so I definitely like the character stories a lot more. I'm going to continue playing it. I don't know... what else there's to say about it unless people have questions. But I mean
so the dungeon design, even though they've like skinned them better, is still that kind of like uninspired, randomly generated.
So I
did hear that Persona 5 actually has like good dungeon design.
I will say I honestly kind of like the dungeon design in 3 more than 4.
You've done the bathhouse one, right?
Yes. Yes,
I like the bathhouse.
Yeah, that is.
Not from a design standpoint.
It's all music and look
thematically.
To Brad's comment in 3,
bath time.
You were in one big building at 256 floors.
Yeah,
and every X amount of floors, it was the same thing except for just kind of slightly different skins. Like the cut flooring was different. Whereas in this, it is a lot more in depth. The music is definitely much different in every one. The themes are very different. Yeah, you start off like in like a, I can't remember what the first one was, but then the second one's like a castle. And the third one is the bathhouse, and then it's like a striptease like place, and there's all these like women behind curtains and shit. And I think that's the last one I've done. But yeah, no. So the difference in each dungeon I feel is different. But in 3 compared to 4, like 3, was a bunch of like rooms next to each other. Whereas this is a bunch of hallways with a room every once in a while. And yeah. I hate like running down those really long hallways, mm-hmm. especially because if you go the wrong way and it's a dead end, you have to go all the way back. Whereas I feel in 3, you never were on a floor for so long that you weren't like right near an exit. Mm-hmm. I guess the nice thing about this compared to 3 is as soon as you find the exit, at any point in time, you can always just go to the next floor. You don't have to go back and find the exit again.
Yeah.
That's a nice change. Man. And I'm sure something like that will also be in 5.
I'm a little disappointed by the romantic options in this game because you got Yukiko and Chie, right?
Yes.
And then you get Risei, who's not even a in-battle character.
Yeah.
And that kind of kills it for me a little bit. Like, I'm the love of my life has to fight along with me. And you eventually get to Naoto, but that's so late in the game.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Naoto.
Naruto.
Oh, I don't. Okay. You know, let's stop talking about Persona 4.
I will say in 3, there were definitely plenty of romance like characters that weren't in battle. Like Yuko and Orihime, I think was her name, maybe. There was multiple girls you could have relationships with that weren't in battle with you.
Yeah, I know, but you know, if you're not going to fight with me, we're not going to bone.
Well, it's not about them fighting with you. It's about, well, in fact, in 3, they didn't have personas. Now, I will say that Risei, who I just unlocked her social link in this, I don't think she goes into combat with you because the way she talked, it says like she's almost like a teddy, like she analyzes battle maybe.
Yeah,
or
yeah.
Okay. So I mean that she's helping out in her own way. She's doing stuff.
Brad operates under Red Sonja rules.
Oh, okay.
For well, sure.
Anyway, I'm definitely enjoying this. I hate that Final Fantasy 15 just came out. Because these are both in fucking Watch Dogs and Dishonored and everything's now coming out.
You got four months.
I know, I still have time.
Just on the,
I and mean, I restarted Dark Souls 3 5, the other day.
5 got delayed.
What till March?
Till
April.
April. Okay. April 4th. So I still have, what, 5 months?
Yep.
Just about 5 months or 4 months, I guess, to finish this.
Do a day a day.
That's not enough time, I don't think. That's because I think this game ends in January and I'm in like July right now, so I need at least like 7 months maybe.
Does this make you want to play the Persona 4 fighting game?
No, not at all.
Really?
Yeah.
Like yeah. It's an Arc System Works game and the Guilty Gear guys, which means like it's fucking like the representation of those characters in fighting game form is kind of like fucking rad as shit.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean,
but you also
Arc System Works fighting games are pretty like fun to. It's not like Street Fighter, like you can mash out some really cool looking shit without much effort. So
mm-hmm.
Maybe when Crispy plays Persona 4, we'll play the fighting.
It's so sad, man. I was really enjoying Persona 4, mm-hmm. and I just got to that point. I was like, oh, I don't want to do all that over again when I lost.
But
that.
You did it. All
I started
over again.
Doing it again, but then I just got to the point where I was like, oh. Like, still, I had to do, like, 20 hours of this thing I already
honestly,
did.
I admire...
It killed it for
I replayed 70 hours of Persona 3.
Man, I don't know. It's just...
Should I play Persona 4? Or should I just wait for 5?
No, like,
just
play honestly,
for
I'm
wait
hoping...
For five. Wait for 5.
I'm hoping 5 improves enough on the stuff that I didn't like about 4 that 5 will just kind of fill that void that I'm feeling from not finishing 4.
I'm sure it will.
And that maybe 5 will just be the first Persona game that I play from start to finish and... That'll be fine.
Yeah. I'm a little surprised that you're still trucking because...
Me?
Yeah, why? Because I got so burnt out on this. And I totally intend to finish before 5 comes out, but I played it heavily for a short period of time, and then I just... Like, it gets, like, exhaustive. Especially... Well, I don't want to say anything else about the game, but...
Are you farther than me in the story, I guess?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like 65 hours in this game.
Oh, so. Okay. Well, okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Do we want to, switching gears here, do we want to say, I mean, I personally have played a shit ton of Dishonored 2. In fact, I finished it.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Sorry about that. We had to take a quick pause there so we could fix the camera issue. Anyways, what I was saying, Dishonored 2, I beat that game.
Mm-hmm.
Low chaos, right?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I did. I don't want to spend a whole bunch. There's not a whole lot to discuss.
Did you take back what's yours?
Yes.
Spoilers.
Point is, so there's I think the Dishonored the jump from Dishonored 1 to 2,
mm-hmm.
mechanically speaking, I wouldn't say it's very dramatic.
Yeah.
I think part of that is because Dishonored 1 does so many things right, and they just kind of carry that over to 2 and just maybe flush it out just a little bit more. A lot of the powers are really fucking cool. I'm digging that. Everyone was talking, before we did the last podcast, I hadn't done the Clockwork Mansion. I did the Clockwork Mansion. That mission is probably one of the best designed levels I've ever seen in a fucking video game. Fucking crazy. Like, the way the walls are turning around, the way... Have you haven't played it yet.
No. I've only played an hour of Dishonored.
I don't even know how to describe it without spoiling it, or if anyone is, I don't know if people have already spoiled
it for you. We talked about it the last part.
If you saw the CG trailer, mm-hmm. the first one they showed.
Yeah. I don't think I did.
You didn't?
I didn't watch a whole lot of.
It's Aperture Science testing facility. Okay. Basically, it has a mansion.
Walls are moving.
Yeah. All the walls are panels, and they move around.
But you can move rooms in between the panels as they're turning and get access.
Just like Aperture Science, where you can like.
Cool.
But it's like a big open level, maybe unlike Aperture, because in Aperture Science, I mean, Portal, you're
the Portal comparisons will never end, Nick. You can't shake them. Okay.
Sure. But I played that mission and I was like, holy fucking shit! Like, not only is like that was a really impressive level, and then I was like, well, how the fuck are they gonna, like, they dropped that in the middle of the game, maybe even closer towards the beginning of the game, and it's like, so what the fuck is, like, everything is gonna after this is going to feel less good.
Yeah.
Which to a degree was true. Like, all the levels are really well designed, even the ones that are, you know, basic, not static levels that don't shift and move. But they do another mission later that I think is equally as impressive in terms of level design. And I don't want to spoil it. I will say, like, everyone was talking about that one level in Titanfall 2, right? This is similar to that, but better.
Slow the fuck down.
It is. It's better. It is. Like, I could tell you right now, and you'd be like, what the fuck?
Story's better in the first one, right?
Story of what, Dishonored?
Yeah.
I mean, I think the story in both of them is about the same. Like, I mean, not the same, but like, in turn,
it's
like,
almost the same story.
As far as quality, like, I wouldn't say one is any better than the other. Like, I feel like two is just a kind of a pretty natural continuation of the story in one. It feels very cohesive from one to two. In fact, just both games, I think, meld together really nicely. The one point I drove home about Dishonored 2 is, like, that game has some fucking incredible level design. Even outside of those two highlight missions,
are you playing with all your markers turned on?
Yeah. I didn't turn off.
I stopped right before the Clockwork Mansion, and I intend to turn off markers.
And I probably would, except it's one of those games where I kind of wanted to... Well, I didn't want to miss anything.
I got back into Hitman, and I turned off markers.
Yeah.
Like objective markers.
Yeah.
And it made, like...
It makes it more immersive, for sure.
It reminded me how I liked Hitman before.
I mean, the beauty of Dishonored is that you can do the same thing, and I would imagine it would be just as satisfying in Dishonored versus Hitman.
Because, like, stuff is well done in Dishonored. Like, there's, like, signs and like, there's things that tell you what things are, and you're going to explore all of the environment anyways, right?
Yeah.
And you're going to, like, search all the nooks and crannies, so why not just do it without the markers?
You're going to find everything you need if you're playing that way anyways.
I feel like, even with the game telling me where to go, I'm still spending, like, two hours on a level.
No,
if I turn the markers off, I would never finish the game. I would languish in an alley somewhere.
With the markers on, I spent... on average, 3.5 hours on every mission.
I'm gonna try.
Ultimately, by the time I was finished with the game, I had spent, I think my clock was like 23 hours or something.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said earlier in the show, like the one kind of thing that I was doing consistently was I was trying my best to react to situations that, like, when shit goes wrong and just
go with the flow
of it. Yeah. Doesn't always work out that way, but when it does, I would keep that shit. So, like, my kill count was fairly low. Like, one of the you can, like, rewire, like, the walls of light stuff, and you tend to rewire them and leave them and then forget about them.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, there was one time I rewired a wall of light, walked through it, and I just kept going. I never looked back, never saw anything, what transpired there. and I didn't kill anyone in the mission, and I got to the end and it said that I had killed like 6 people. Mm-hmm. And I'm pretty sure they all walked through that wall of light, but yeah. I was no, like, I wasn't
anywhere around.
I didn't see it. I was too far away. And that shit's just fucking cool. Like, Dishonored is such a well-made fucking video game. And the mechanics work so well. That's really all I can say about it. But if you haven't yet played it...
I'm going to finish it.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah, I'm Crispy, going to play it. You're, with your Clockwork Mansion scenario, I know you... Because I know Crispy said he got to a point where he had to escort that dude out.
It's probably not nearly as big a deal as I'm making it out to be. It's just like I was saying, like I had... Like, the Clockwork Mansion level is so big because the mansion itself is only, like, the last half of the level. Like, you have to work through this big, like, city area to get onto a train, to get to another city area, to get to the bridge, to go to the mansion, and then you go into the mansion, and then it's that big, like, fucking Rubik's Cube of a house.
Maybe it's, like,
and
a throwback
then, like,
to that thief
I go
level.
All the way, I go all the way through that mansion, and I get to a point, like, I've cleared most of my path out. I've taken out a lot of guards. Like by this point, I've spent, like, 2.5 hours on this level. I find the objective. They're like, okay, now get out. And as soon as I turn a corner, like, every guard I've taken out has been replaced, and then there's more guards on top of that, and I'm just like, I'm gonna go play Watch Dogs. I just had a little bit of fatigue. I need to walk away and not talk to Dishonored for like 2 weeks.
Which you've done. So I would just implore you to go back because it's amazing. If only to get to that one level, because you will love that level.
The big thing killing my progress in this game right now is the fact that I feel like I can't sit down and, like, just play it for half an hour and then walk away. Like starting a mission is, like, this is going to take another 2 or 3 hours to finish. And that's no fault of the games. That's just my own personal scheduling. Like, I just don't have time to sit down and do that.
It is a beefy
as
game.
Much.
I just want everybody to know that Chris Davis seems very proud of the fact that he played through Dishonored 2 without any powers.
Which I think is fucking... I'm sorry, I'm going
to
stop.
A bad idea, but... I just want everybody to know that it probably was very challenging, but he did it.
And that, as impressive as that is, why'd you do that, man? Why? That's not fun! I feel like playing Dishonored 2 without powers is like the antithesis of fun.
I played through all of GTA 5 only walking. I never got in a car.
That's like the equivalent. That's the same fucking thing.
It was super immersive and challenging. Especially the chases.
I think Chris Davis, I say this with the utmost respect, I think you're crazy. Okay, let's move on. I think we've exhausted our list of games today. Like I said, if there's anything that we talked about throughout the show that you'll want to chime in on, whether you play one of the games or not, be sure to leave a comment on the site at 4playernetwork.com. Do we have any news this week?
Yes.
Then
not really, but yeah.
No, we do.
Go for it, Brad. It sounds like you're ready.
Potentially big news.
Potentially big news.
This was rumored. A lot of rumors going on about this. And Polygon says, yeah, it's real. Uh-huh. Marvel vs. Capcom 4, which, you know, I mean, yeah. I know y'all don't care about fighting games, but, like, it's a pretty big deal for the fighting game community. I've always been super fond of the series, even though I've never...
Marvel Capcom's cool, though.
...really had fucking friends to play it with, I guess you could say. Y'all know about Marvel vs. Capcom, right?
Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
We're all aware.
It's cool.
It is very much this, like all the dream characters now in, like, fighting game form. That,
did
that
you
sort
see
of thing.
The proposed
they put
Marvel?
Phoenix right into a fighting game. That's just cool, right?
Yeah.
No, you know, it is. Like, it's, like, you know, it started way back in the day with, like, Street Fighter versus X-Men or whatever, right? And which was cool. And through all these years, they've been adding all these, like, awesome characters, like fucking Mega Man and Jill from Jill Valentine, you know?
When did Jill from Jill Valentine.
Well,
when did...
No, no, Jill from Resident Evil.
Yeah. When did Marvel vs. Capcom 3 come out?
It's been a while.
It was a few years ago.
It was like 2011 or 12.
What I'm trying to tell you is I didn't even realize that was a thing.
Yeah, for sure. They did like two re-releases of it.
Oh,
shit.
I mean, that just shows you how closely I follow
Did you see the proposed Marvel character list?
Well, so that's the bigger part of the news is that, according to Polygon, X-Men are out. Which they've been a huge part of the roster since the beginning when it was called X-Men vs. Street Fighter. Like, you're talking about Wolverines. Marvel's Capcom 2 had two Wolverines. You know, like that
might be symptomatic of a larger change happening within Marvel.
Well, so they're suggesting that it's going to be all MCU.
It's like the list I saw. Like I was talking to Chai before the show, and he sent me like a graphic of like all the proposed characters. It is everyone's favorite characters from MCU and
the show
and Gwenpool, which is the Spider-Gwen version of Deadpool. Yeah. It's a chick Deadpool.
Yeah.
Oh, so that's how they get around it?
Yeah. Yeah.
So
I wouldn't be surprised if Spider-Gwen or Squirrel-Girl maybe like show up as DLC or maybe end up in the roster. And Howard the Duck. Yeah, but everybody else, it's Star-Lord and Loki and
Daredevil.
Like, Daredevil and the Punisher, like
I don't Iron think Daredevil's Fist. Ever been in one of these games either. Maybe as an assist.
I
don't recall him.
If I play this game, I'm going to play as Daredevil.
They also got... calling it now. Well, you pick three characters typically, so...
Well, fuck.
And that's Punisher of the cool assist.
That's one of the cool parts about this series is you pick multiple characters. So, like, in that last game...
Three
Cyclopses.
They
had Beautiful Joe, Amaterasu, and Dante from Devil May Cry, so I could pick, like, three characters from Hideki Kamiya games. Mm-hmm. And that's cool. Like, it's just fan service to the max. So, like, I get excited, not just for the Marvel side, but for the Capcom side. And I've always loved the idea of these games, but I feel like they always come out, like, at a bad time, you know? Three came out after I started broadcasting, and I didn't really play fighting games with people. And two was way back, in the 90s, and that one came out. So maybe this is the one where I'm finally going to hop on board. And I'm cool. I mean, MCU... just means I know who all the fucking characters are, and there's not going to be a weird little tentacle guy, and I'm like, who the fuck is this?
That's tentacle.
Shuma Gorath?
That is...
You what? Said that just so you can get this reaction out of Crispy, didn't
Wait,
you?
Wait, of course.
No, does
nah,
he...
Nah, but,
I mean, that feels like your
explanation for that makes total sense, and I feel like there's a lot of people out there probably into that, but it's like...
But people didn't use Shuma Gorath because they don't know who Shuma Gorath
was. I know. But it's just, it's like, I, you know what, this isn't the conversation we need to have right now, and I'm being a dick. Go ahead. Continue.
Well, I mean, they're not only picking the most popular characters. I think having Wasp in there is kind of inspired.
They put Wasp in there because they're
going to do
Ant-Man that has the Wasp in it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I know why they're in there, but I'm saying it's not like they only picked fucking Iron Man and Captain America.
So when are we expecting this announcement? Is it going to be tomorrow at the VGA?
That list is
possibly.
It's like the Avengers and Loki and like the characters from Guardians of the Galaxy that people liked and Daredevil and Punisher. And Iron Fist. It's like every. It's
Is
like
Luke
every.
Cage in there?
And Black Panther. No, it's like every project that either hit really big recently or is about to hit, and they think is going to hit really big.
But what's wrong with them?
No, I know. I get it. But it's like there's so many. You're talking about the House of Ideas. This is Marvel we're talking about.
Iron Fist.
Yeah, I know. That's great. Well, he's got his show coming out next year. Obviously, he's going to be in it.
Mm-hmm. I'm actually kind of.
I'm going through right now.
MODOK is in, bitch.
Yeah, MODOK is in all of them. Like, MODOK was in two, wasn't he? MODOK was in the last one?
No, he was just in the last one.
He wasn't in two?
No.
Oh, I thought he was.
All right.
MODOK's. He's cool.
Is he top tier?
No.
He's from the X-Men cartoon show?
Definitely like, not top tier. I don't think I've ever seen him in tournament.
Like, I'm pretty sure you'll find a way to invalidate this, but I kind of feel with this what you maybe felt with Smash Brothers when Smash Brothers was coming out, and it was all, like, Fire Emblem shit.
No, but so here is why it's good, though.
Like, there's so many great characters that they could just be
talking. No. It gives them the opportunity to do a bunch of fresh new characters because Wolverine coming back isn't exciting. And maybe you don't care that much about Star-Lord because, everyone likes Guardians of the Galaxy. Who even is Star-Lord? I don't know what your reasoning is, but I kind of want to see him in fighting game form because he wasn't in the last one. Having more new characters is always cool in a fighting game. And that's the reason I would be excited. Wasp shrinks down?
My point is
because that's kind of cool in fighting game
there
form.
There are cool characters. You could introduce... new characters that are not only cool in fighting game form, but are also just like cool new characters that you get to learn about.
Remember what we were talking about with the Persona 4 fighting game? It's like, I really enjoy this character in this other form.
I want to see, like, and Marvel's Capcom is great at this, like, a really badass interpretation of a translation of that to a fighting game. Right. And I get to see that with some of the characters who I actually know what they are.
Like Marth. I was really excited when they put, like, the new Lady Marth
Lucina. Okay, listen, if they had every single Guardian of the Galaxy, maybe I'd be a little frustrated.
All right. Y'all know this is an argument no one's going to win, so let's move on.
This is an argument nobody cares about. Yeah, that's why true. I didn't want to have it, but go ahead.
Fair enough. All right. Is there any more news? Tomorrow is the Video Game Awards, right?
Is it tomorrow?
Tomorrow night.
Oh, wow. And PSX is this weekend?
Oh, shit.
PSX. By this time next week, we're going to have a ton of news to talk about. There'll be a ton of game announcements. There will be games we're talking about on next week's podcast that we don't even know exist yet. So we'll have a bigger news segment next week. So, Nolan, are you ready for the community?
Yeah. Sorry, I had a work email. I can stop that though, because this is clearly more important.
Clearly,
Killer Frost was cool in Injustice.
What the fuck is
anyway,
your fucking
it's
point?
It's time for the
Brad.
Community. Shut the fuck up,
Brad.
Yay!
This is why you're an asshole and you're the worst.
Hey, it's the community.
Oh my god, these two right
so,
here.
So, how about we just you're just gonna jump straight?
Hypocrite.
Oh my god, guys. Fucking
continue.
Stop.
I'm sorry.
I'm gonna
our community is not hypocrites.
No, the
They're
community
lovely
is not.
People.
Brad. He was referring specifically to Brad when he said
some questions from our patrons.
Questions from our patrons.
Because we don't have any new patrons.
Crispy's not a patron.
Is Brad?
I'm just gonna go over here and I'm going to mute Crispy and Brad. There we go. Shut the fuck up. So the first question this week from the Metal Button. With the advent of Marvel and DC... God damn it.
Really?
Skipping that one.
Are you fucking
Come
serious?
On. You said it. You have to read it.
With the advent of Marvel and DC having cinematic universes, what is your opinion on other films outside of the comic book movie genre following suit? Example... Do you feel that Prometheus or 10 Cloverfield Lane benefit from their shared movie counterparts or fail from being extra baggage by shoehorning in plot points to make them fit?
What was the other one you said? Prometheus and what?
10 Cloverfield Lane.
10 Cloverfield Lane. Well, the problem with Prometheus is that it's just not good.
Oh, yeah. That there was more.
There isn't even that much of them like shoehorning alien shit in there. It's just like not a good
movie. But Magneto is good in it.
Brad, can you...
No, I mean, I'm saying, what's his name?
Mike Fassbender.
Mike Fassbender. Oh,
I thought you, I was about to be like, just let it go, Brad.
Well,
just let it go.
Right? He is an X-Men.
Yes, He is. God, fuck, just shut the fuck up.
And it depends on how
it's
done.
It's a hard question to answer.
No, it is. And so, like, 10 Cloverfield Lane, I thought was well done, mainly because it was a good movie that took place in the same universe. So yeah, that was well done.
Like
for me,
personally, like look at like Harry Potter and the Fantastic Beasts, like that's mm-hmm. starting to like branch that universe out and open it up in ways that, you know, we didn't think were going to happen. I think as long as those movies are done well and they expand that universe, sure. Why the hell not? That seems like an exciting addition. Like as long as you, if the audience wants to see more of that universe, any attempt to expand that is welcome. But you know, you really do have to tread lightly because, yeah. You know, Prometheus has some serious problems.
Yeah, it does.
And
not
Alien.
Being able to turn right is one of them.
Or no, left. No, you know what's great?
Not being
you know
able
what's
to turn.
Fucking great? What, oh God, what game was I playing on the feed recently where I was, something was falling and I was running and it was, shit you not, straight out of Prometheus. I was running, it was falling and I was running fucking
straight away.
I could have run to the right or left and... I survived, huh? But like, it missed me by like that much. What the fuck game was that? I was broadcasting. Oh no, it was Dark Souls 3. I was fighting that big tree boss. Oh. You know, it does an attack where it rolls onto its back. Yeah. It rolled backwards, and I was running. I was running away from it exactly like the girl in fucking Prometheus. Yeah. And I was like, so you know, maybe it's just like a maybe it's just a reaction you have in a stressful situation. You just forget how to go right or left. Yeah. I don't fucking know.
All right, moving on. Next question from Burnsy. With Persona 5 on the horizon, new social links for us to go through, Nolan going through Persona 3 and Persona 4, it got me thinking, where would you think your social links with each other are? Are they maxed out? Are they still level 1? Would Brad take a fatal blow for Chris Davis? Who would die for each other? Have links been made?
I don't know how to, I guess I don't understand the social links.
So in Persona games, social links, if you don't ever talk to somebody, you have no social link with them. As soon as you kind of establish a somewhat acquaintanceship, it's social links at one, the more time you spend with them and the better your relationship becomes, it becomes higher and higher. The higher your relationship becomes, they will aid you in battle in different ways.
Are social links always inherently positive?
I would say it's more like Dragon Age 2's relationship system, where you can like kind of become a rival, but you still get like new skills. Because
I was going to say, Crispy and Brad are like for definitely linked socially in some significant way. Maybe not positive, but I don't know.
I mean, I would say I'm above at least a 4 with everybody.
What's the, on a scale of 10?
Yeah, 1 to 10.
4? Really?
I said above. I said I'm above.
Yeah, but that could be anywhere. It could be 5.
Nick, I remember the day that I created my social link with you, if that makes you feel any better.
We're not supposed to talk about that on the show.
Oh, I just said I remember it.
I thought we'd never speak
of that. Is that the day we were looking at the Dragon Ball Z poster?
Probably.
I feel like our social link grew dramatically that day, Nolan.
Yeah. Anyway.
Anybody else have any social links they care to talk about?
I'm not a very sociable person.
He's not.
Yeah, Brad has no social links, period.
Yeah. You try and become friends with Brad and he just denies you.
I have a really high social link with at least 2 of the people on this podcast.
Yeah, probably.
Oh my god. I feel like we're all at least socially linked to Brad, but even if it's like at a 2.
Yeah.
Maybe a 3.
He just keeps pushing us away.
He just keeps pushing us back down.
This is what happens when you're antisocial, is people start blaming the antisocial person.
Just pushes us away. Yeah,
it's their fault.
Mm-hmm. That was the joke. You don't have to stop inviting me to stuff. Sometimes maybe I'll say yes.
Hey, you could have invited me to dinner the other day.
What?
When you were at my house and you left your PS4 and you went to go have dinner and then came back after dinner to get your PS4?
Well, I mean, you... Oh, my God. Do you want to go ask Malia why I didn't invite you? Because you said you couldn't leave your fucking house.
Oh, yeah. I should. I know. I mean, I shouldn't have.
And I brought you food.
You did after I asked you. You could have. An invite was all I wanted.
Man, that was awesome.
It's fine.
I'm glad we've clarified this, but that was awesome.
He couldn't leave.
It's not about the fact that I couldn't. It's about the fact that you could have asked.
And then you would have said, I already told you.
No, I wouldn't.
Why didn't you write it down?
Oh, man.
I think
we need to do?
Social links are going down.
I think we need to, as a group, we need to go to like a real therapist like together. Like before, and like film that shit and put that.
That'd be interesting.
Can you legally do that? I don't know. But that would be great.
Anyway, moving on. We got a couple of questions we got to get through. Nick the Batman asks, what is the dumbest name you've ever given to something? For example, as a kid, when my... Togepi hatched in Pokemon Silver, I named it Eggy Cool.
Sounds like a Capri Sun.
That's a good question. Okay. The dumbest thing I've ever named something.
I once named Cloud in Final Fantasy VII the Shiznit. Well, when I was just like, oh, let's go back to the beginning of the game and see what the beginning is like again.
Yeah.
When I was playing it for the first time, and I overwrote my save.
Oh.
I had to
start the game over again.
I'm lame, and I don't actually ever give any characters in video games names other than what they are.
The default.
I think I'm playing Dark Souls 3 right now. I think, and I named my character Bay. Like that's like the craziest thing I've ever done. I don't know.
Bay.
I named my Dark Souls 2 character Hodor. Because we had just I started the game literally the night that episode, that big episode.
Mm-hmm. Really? That's how long ago you started?
Yeah.
Oh wow.
So.
Alyssa,
remember you were there.
I believe
there. We watched that episode. Right. You came in the room and you were like, name him Hodor.
The question was, what was the dumbest name you've ever given something? Hodor. I don't think naming Dick Butt is dumb.
Yeah.
You're incorrect.
I always name my band and rock band or guitar hero. I guess you name them both. The Hokuten Knights. Which was the Knights from Final Fantasy Tactics.
That's pretty dumb.
Yeah.
My Jade Empire character was named the Crispy One, but they don't ever say your name, I don't think. So, doesn't really matter.
It's racist.
Yep, I think
that's... How is that racist?
Just is.
How? Explain.
I demand an answer. Next
question. All right. Next question from Umi Dori, who I believe is Chris Davis's brother or maybe a father. It says, "Hi, guys. Longtime listener here in Boston. Thanks for the great vibe of the show. I feel sad when some of you don't take The Division seriously. Aside from Warframe, it's the closest thing we, as PC players, have to Destiny. The newest patch has cleaned up and balanced the game incredibly, and the excitement and activity has gone almost gone back to the level it was during the beta."
Fucking Chris Davis, my man.
"I think now it is a great time to jump back in or explore the game more if you haven't completed it. Umi Dori, I will say that now is a horrible time to jump into that game because there are too many other games that we're trying to play before Chris Davis's arbitrary deadline for end of the year."
I like that, which by the way is today.
No, it's Sunday.
I like that his argument.
I thought it was December 1st.
Today's not December 1st.
That's tomorrow, right?
Tomorrow. Yeah.
It's Sunday, though.
Sunday.
Okay. His preliminary list.
All right. Anyway, the point is, I don't think we're not taking The Division seriously. I think it's that we're not taking Chris Davis's obsession with The Division seriously.
I do like that his
argument, played the game 400+ hours.
His appeal for The Division is it's the closest thing we're gonna get to Destiny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is another game that we really don't take very seriously.
Yeah. I don't really have. I mean, the Division looks like a fine game. It's not really my cup of tea.
It's delightful.
I don't know what else to tell you. I think it's just that we like making fun of Chris Davis because he's played it for
and that is the main
400
reason.
400 plus. I say 400 plus hours, but I think he said 400 plus hours, and that was like 6 months ago. So at this point, who the fuck knows what it is?
Amount of time.
What is it? What is it, Chris Davis? Tell us. What is your
That's not true.
You've only played 40 hours in the last like 6 months.
I don't believe you. 440 can't be accurate. Like, you're employed. Like, that's not a real.
The Division's been out for a while.
That's not real.
Well, it did come out this year, didn't it? Holy shit.
You know what came out this year? Pokken Tournament. I played that, so I had to write it down on a list.
Yes, you did. All right. Nolan, next question.
Final question from the evening, quickly, from Michael M. Fuck, Mary, Kill, HBO edition. Cersei from Game of Thrones, Carmella Soprano from The Sopranos.
And the wife?
Yes.
Oh, Carmella's the wife?
Yes.
Oh, I thought it was the daughter.
Nope.
This changes everything.
Or Sookie Stackhouse from True Blood.
Oh, right. Kill immediately.
I've never seen True Blood.
That's a rogue.
Yeah, kill. Her voice is
annoying. No, I would fuck Sookie Stackhouse, I would kill Cersei Lannister, and I would marry Carmella.
Oh, I would fuck all of them.
Can I kill all of them?
No, fuck them.
I mean, they're all just... honestly, I haven't
Lena
seen...
Lena Headey.
I have not seen enough.
I never said she wasn't.
No, but she fucks his brother.
It's not Lena Headey, it's Cersei Lannister.
I'd still fuck Cersei.
Yeah.
Even though she's been fucking...
I don't mind sloppy seconds from
it's not like you're gonna get an from Jamie incest.
Oh my god!
Yeah, I'm sure he wants to Eiffel Tower.
Everyone
Cersei with
fucked
Jamie.
Cersei. Everyone's fucked Cersei.
All right, I don't
That's
know.
Not true.
I don't know enough about Everyone The Sopranos because I shamefully have not seen The Sopranos.
Exactly two people.
She is the,
exactly two
the wife of Tony Soprano.
Yeah, but
so she's just an
how
old.
How despicable is she? Because I'm assuming
three.
Either,
I'm sorry, you're
she's
right,
not
three.
That bad. Exactly she's just three. Like an older Guido lady. So she's like Italian.
I bet
so.
She can cook really well.
Yeah, right, she does cook well.
All right, I would fuck her, I would marry Sookie, and I would kill Cersei.
So I don't know enough about
that
Sookie.
That is bullshit.
That
Sookie
is
Stackhouse
choice?
Is Anna Paquin. That's enough.
I know the actress, but
that's
I mean,
enough. That's all you need
Anna
to know.
Paquin?
Yeah, I think she has her moments.
Yeah, she's listening to her talk is terrible.
So I guess in that case, I would kill Sookie, I would fuck Cersei, and I would probably marry Carmella.
I mean, Reborn is like over here screaming
yeah,
from the
wait,
rooftops, don't
Cersei?
Marry Carmella.
Yeah. I would marry Carmella.
Yeah,
I don't know. Anything.
I'd marry Carmella. She's, yeah.
She always stuck with Tony through thick and thin.
Well, and
for the most
she
part.
Would, she'd call him out on his bullshit. Dude, yeah. I mean, she was a great character on that show. So. She seemed like a good wife. I mean, she had her problems, obviously, married to a sociopath and being like completely okay with it, but you know, hey.
Well, they all have problems.
Yeah.
All right. There you go. Thank you, guys.
I'd fuck them all. Fuck it.
Thank you guys for your questions.
That's always my answer.
If you want to ask us questions, we accept questions.
Wait, from our... one more bonus fuck, marry, kill.
Oh, my God.
Prompto, Gladiolus, or
Ignis.
Ignis. Thank you guys.
Ignis. No, seriously.
Marry Ignis.
Because he can cook. And he's also, he's delightful.
He's really responsible.
He's just a really nice guy. He's just always calm, and he I feel like he'd be there for you, like a shoulder to cry on.
He could be my rock.
Kill Prompto.
That's too easy. You know, Gladiolus, though.
He feels like he'd be rough.
He's bookish. He'll occasionally pull out a book.
That is true.
It's fine that, like, if you guys want to kill Prompto or whatever, but I just feel like it's such an out of hand, like, I feel like you're not giving him a chance.
I mean, especially if you watch Final Fantasy Brotherhood,
youthful demeanor is quite refreshing to me.
He's a pretty endearing character after you watch Brotherhood. That's actually a really hard one.
Yeah. Marry all of them. Fuck all of them.
Bro, marry.
Kill none of them.
None of them.
Thank you guys for your questions. If you if you're a supporter of us on Patreon, at patreon.com/4player, you can leave us a question for next week's episode, and we'll answer it on the show. So it is time to wrap up with the 4Player Minute. We say our hype, our fuck, our thank you, and our sweat of the week. Right? Did I say that right?
Yeah.
So Brad's going to start us off. Go.
My hype and sweat are, of course, the same thing. Next week, finally, the release of The Last Guardian, which, you know, could potentially be a very meaningful game to me because, hey, the first two were, and there's a lot of pressure on this game.
Yep.
I don't know if it's going to meet it, but a lot of the previews were negative. But then again, I could have easily seen those same previews to Eco. So we'll see. I'm very excited. Both those games are two of my very favorite games of all time. And, you know, this is a lot riding on this one. A lot more than Final Fantasy 15 for me. My thank you, I'm going to give my thank you to Respawn. You know, I finished Titanfall 2 today. Sorry, I did that last boss fight off the feed. But, you know, bravo for you know, that first one, they got a lot of shit for not doing a campaign. And they did a campaign this time, and even though it was kind of like a shorter Call of Duty style campaign, I feel like they put a lot of effort into trying to come up with some fresh ideas, like with, you know, like the fucking time manipulation level is fucking cool as shit. You know, like seriously cool as shit. When you combine it with like the action that's in that game, playing through that made me wish that I had the time to play multiplayer games, because I think that would be the one I would be playing right now.
Playing through that just made me wish there was a Singularity too.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I mean, you know, the people who made Singularity make Call of Duty games, which are work on Call of Duty games, and they all stole all the shit from Titanfall. So, you know, you're kind of getting there somehow.
No.
My fuck you for the week, I'm just going to give it to Nintendo, just because I think about it every now and then, how sad it is that Bayonetta amiibo still isn't out. And that they're probably, I believe the rumor is they're delaying it for the release of the Switch and whatever that Smash Brothers port that's rumored to be coming to it is. I want my damn Bayonetta amiibo, and it better look good. She better be kicking all cool and shit up there like that.
Okay, you don't have to do it.
Yeah. Like, ooh, like with the whip maybe. Anyways, that's all.
All right, Nolan?
So, my 4Player Minute starts... right now, go. My hype is for more Final Fantasy 15. I've definitely been enjoying that more than I thought I was going to. I knew I was going to like it, and I knew I was going to have problems with it, but I'm glad my interest in the game is outweighing the problems I have with it.
Yep.
My sweat goes to this Final Fantasy Ultimate Collector's Edition that I got. Kind of want to sell it.
What is in it?
The game, a statue, Kingsglaive Blu-ray, art book, some postcards,
soundtrack. What if I bought the soundtrack from you just straight up?
That's not enough money.
What if, did you open it?
No.
Okay. Is the statue like nice?
Anyway, I don't know what I'm going to do. My thank you does go to Square Enix for sending it early though. Thanks for messing that up, I guess. So a lot of people got their game much earlier.
Yep.
And then
it's the least they could do after 10 years.
Yeah. Yeah, it may not make you wait 2 more days. And then my fuck you this week goes to Final Fantasy 15 as well. for their horrible tutorial and lack of telling you vital information that makes the game a lot more fun.
Yep.
That thankfully, though, I found out today, and so my experience will probably get better.
Cool. Yep.
Which one, the lock-on or...?
The lock-on, the stamina issue are the big two.
I just discovered that on accident, too.
I don't want to have that bar up all there all the time.
The bar only appears when you're actually running. It goes away.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it only shows up when you're using your stamina.
Okay.
It's really not that bad. It hasn't been I wouldn't consider it a distraction or a detriment to the game when you have it on. Crispy?
My hype for this week goes to the Final Fantasy franchise, not just 15. Because I am playing 15 and enjoying it so far, and it's making me more interested in going back and checking out more.
That's funny, because that is literally like the opening statement of the game. That's like their mission statement with this game, is to get people to
I'm not a complete newcomer to Final Fantasy. Like, I have played significant chunks of different games over the years. I've just never actually finished one of them except for Tactics.
Have you played any of 8?
Yeah. Yeah, actually, I did. I never got past... yeah, I've only done like Balamgarden section of 8.
Oh my god!
Like, I never really like got out into.
I love Balamgarden.
I don't often recommend 8 to people, but I think for you, for some reason, I'm going 8.
Okay.
8's good.
There's something about 8 that I really like. Dude, when I was in middle school, like the whole idea of a gunblade was just like cool.
And that was one of the cool things about that game was the fact that you could actually press the trigger as soon as you slash do extra damage.
It was cool. You know, I will never forgive them for locking me out of all of the fucking cities in Disc 4.
Oh, yeah.
Oh. Yeah,
you couldn't backtrack anymore? Yeah,
once you go from Disc 3 to Disc 4, there's an event that happens, and you suddenly can't get back into any cities, towns.
Yeah.
Oh, so you're just stuck out there with whatever
you
have?
See the town on the world map, and there's like a blue circle around it that you can't go past, and you're like, what the fuck?
Fuck. That sucks. I don't think these things. My sweat is for the fact that I'm not going to finish any of these games by the end of the year. I'm not going to. It's just not going to happen. I would like to say that I will, or that I'll try, and I will try, but it's not going to happen, only because I've still got Watch Dogs to finish. I've still got Dishonored, which I basically walked away still in the first like third of that game.
The Witness.
I'm not talking
about Salt and Sanctuary.
I'm not talking about Salt and Sanctuary is not one that I'm
making it worse.
I'm worried about finishing. Should be. I restarted Dark Souls 3. I would like to finish that, but that's not gonna happen.
But I'll tell you, can I say with Dark Souls 3, even if you get through it, it's just more Dark Souls. At least Salt and Sanctuary is kind of a fresh take on Dark Souls.
Yeah. That's fair. I don't know. It didn't hook me. I played a couple hours and it was just like, I get that it's cool, but I don't know. I don't know. Maybe I'm just fickle. Maybe everything sucks. Life is devoid of joy anymore. That happens. I've got two more things that I didn't. I don't have a thank you for the week, I don't think.
Hey.
I don't think I do.
Okay.
I don't know what it would be.
For being in such great spirits every time you see him.
Thank who?
Hyde.
Oh. Thanks, Hyde.
A lovely dog. Yeah.
He always brightens my day.
And thank Manti.
I've never been mad
for taking excellent selfies.
They're so good. They're such
That I tweeted from the 4Player account.
Such good boys. My sweat is... I did sweat. My fuck you is... I don't know.
Is it me?
To Marvel Comics.
Yeah.
For chasing that doll. I mean, you can't blame him. You can't blame him.
You can't.
You really can't.
No. DC's chasing. Marvel already got the dollar.
Yeah, but they're not. It's not like they...
Alrighty then.
They want more dollars.
They're better at chasing than DC is, but they're still chasing. They're chasing hard.
I've got 4 hypes. I'm very hyped this week.
Okay.
First hype is for the VGAs. Not necessarily because, you know, I'm a big fan of the award show, but... I love those announcements.
Mm-hmm.
Jeff Keighley's been doing a pretty good job getting some pretty good announcements every year. I look forward to it. By this time tomorrow, we'll have some new games to talk about, some new games to maybe look forward to. it'll be cool.
Yeah.
My next hype is for The Last Guardian.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking out next week.
Jesus.
Next Tuesday. Can't even fucking believe it. Yeah. What are you doing, Brad?
How do we not talk about the No Man's Sky update? That's huge news.
Yeah.
None of us have played it.
Yeah, that's why.
Maybe.
But, it's fucking news whether we played it or not.
They updated No Man's Sky, and that should have been part of my 4Player minute. I don't know what to think about that. That's crazy. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
It's significant.
It's a lot.
Don't you still have the game?
I do.
Maybe
it's a lot of mechanics to drop in, and I don't.
Maybe boot it up and just try it out the next week. Who the hell knows? My next hype is for fucking movies. A lot of movies out right now. Saw The Arrival. It was fucking excellent. I'm going to see Fantastic Beasts on Friday.
I watched The Lobster.
Edge of 17 looks good.
I'm really, really fucking excited to see La La Land.
Star Wars, guys.
Star Wars is coming out next month.
Rogue One.
Fucking Jason Bourne comes out next week on Blu-ray. I'm going to watch that at least two more times before the end of the year.
Moonlight.
I'm fucking stoked. And my last hype is for more Final Fantasy 15 because against all odds, after a development cycle from hell, 10 years in the making, it came out, and it's not a pile of trash.
It's funny.
It is an enjoyable experience.
It's funny going from 13 to 15, where 15 has stamina, so you literally can't run around the world all day.
It's very true.
Mm-hmm.
Look at that. All right. So that's our show this week, guys. Thank you so much for hanging out. Like I said several times throughout the show, if there's anything that you want to chime in on?
Wait.
Leave a comment.
The nurse in Persona 4.
She fucks you.
Is a slutty bitch.
What? What?
Wait, how far are you with her thing?
I'm pretty far.
I'm sorry, what? Okay, you know what? No. I'm just going to leave that with no context. We'll talk about it after I cut the recording. Anyways, 4playernetwork.com. If you have anything you want to chime in on, leave a comment on 4playernetwork.com on the post for this episode, 481. And we will be back next week. You can watch us broadcast games every single night in the meantime on 4pp.tv or twitch.tv/4playerpodcast. That's all spelled out. But yeah, we'll be back next Wednesday night. But yeah, I forgot to mention at the beginning of the show. For the next, was it 7 weeks? Six to seven weeks. The show will be on Wednesday nights, and then we'll go back to Thursday. But for the foreseeable future, Wednesday nights, 8 p.m. Central Standard Time. So we'll see you next Wednesday with another episode. Thanks for listening. Good night.